And my name is Michel Demarquet. Certain of you saw me, certain never seen before. And I have to thank you very, very much to be interested on what's happened to me in June 1987. And I'm sure you're all here because you want to know more about it. I know a lot of you read the book. You are dying to ask questions. We will do the question at the end of the lecture. Don't worry, you can ask plenty of questions. Now, for those who haven't read the book at all, how many of you didn't read the book? Yeah. Good, few. Okay, so I have to start from the beginning, which was during the night. I was sleeping very quietly in my little hobby farm over there in North Queensland, when suddenly I wake and I was thinking it was the morning, you know, ready to go, fresh, like you had a good night's sleep. Then I went to the kitchen, and in the kitchen I was surprised to see it was 12:30. I dressed up. At that moment, I have to explain to you, because people don't understand really, maybe in a book. At that moment, I became like a zombie in my own house, like if I was telepathized by something, hypnotized. Then I wrote a note to my wife, "Darling, I will be away for 10 days. Oh, why did I do that? It was like two Michelle, one watching the other doing that. I put the note under the telephone. I turned around, I went under the veranda, went down there, and down the stairs, and same time I call it backyard, it's not backyard, it's sort of bushy stuff behind the house because I live next to the rainforest. And I continued to walk. When suddenly under my feet, the ground became bluish, reddish, everything distorted at the light of the star. I could see the house distorted. The philodendron, which is, somebody knows, is a beautiful plant on a tree next to me, start to distort it. And I said, oh, sort of waking up, what am I doing here? I'm sick, I want to go home. And at that precise moment, I've been lifted from the ground and passed on another dimension. At that part of the book, the translator said to me, oh, because the book being written in French originally, and my English is not good enough to write directly in English, unfortunately. And translator said, Michel, you should change that part of the book, because suddenly you are in your garden, after that you are sitting on a rock somewhere else. I say, I'm very, very sorry, I prefer to explain that later, but I can't change anything in that book except the postscript, which is really what I think about it. That the rest have been forbidden to me to change one word of it. So I can't change that part, even if I don't like that part myself. So what's happened when suddenly I appear, as I say, in front of a huge human being, 10 feet high, who look at me with a smile, a transparent helmet, and say, oh, everything will be all right, Michel, in French, which is my own language. I said, you must be joking, I'm dreaming, because we are in Australia, first of all, why do you speak to French to me? And she said, I say, we speak English here, and she says, so do I in English. So I said, that's it, it's a dream, I'm going to fall upon a carpet, I'm dreaming, I'm in my bed. And she said, no, 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 you are not dreaming, we came, we don't want you to think you are dreaming at all, we came to pick you up physically, and to make you doing a trip which nobody ever done, at least on this century, on this planet. You have to remember, all of you, that sentence, because later in a lecture, we are going to use it. It's very interesting. If I don't use it, because I can forget, it's so many things to say. At the question time, you remind me about that sentence. Now, what's happened? I was in a different universe. I saw people passing a bit further in last century costume. And I say, who are those people? And she said, we are in a parallel universe to Earth. Here the time stopped. Those people are there for hundreds of years. If you stay here 200 years, you can go out, example, and look exactly the same match 200 years later. I didn't understand quite at that time, but I explained that, of course, in a book very, very well. The parallel universe is a sort of curse all around the planet. Now I'm going to explain to you something. The planet Earth. Everybody heard, I hope, about the Bermuda Triangle. And simply, around the planet, you have a parallel universe turning around. And that parallel universe, if you remember the Bermuda Triangle, by the way, is a place where people say plane disappear, ship disappear, people disappear, object disappear, birds disappear. So many people say, oh yes, yes, it is the UFO, it is what they call a flying saucer, picking people and kidnapping them. It is not. It could, because it is UFO, which are different of my aliens, but it is not that. Some of the people say, oh yes, it is the pyramid of Atlantis which trapped people. It's also false. It is simply the parallel universe is flipping like a sheet of nylon in a wind and sometimes touching our universe more often on the place of that Bermuda Triangle, that place in Atlantic. It is a very well-known place. So each time if the parallel universe touches that place, it's at the same moment a ship, a plane, a human being passed, disappear and trap in a parallel universe. The parallel universe is a different dimension of our dimension. So when you go there also you are trapped, as I say already a few times, and as I talk to Tao, it's a curse, difficult, some people came out of it by accident also as they went on and they are fortunate. Some became amnesia, they don't remember what happened. Others came also out and they don't want to talk about it because they say, if I dare to talk about what's happened to me, everybody is going to think I'm a cuckoo. And some people even take me for a cuckoo. Do I look like a cuckoo?
I can't tell it by looks.
Very good. Like the cover of the book. Okay. Now, at that moment, Tao told me that, and she said, we are going to take you for a trip, as I said before. And I said, you must be joking. What for? And she said, you are going to witness what we are going to show you with your physical body and report it in a book. I say, you must be joking, because I'm a gardener. I'm not a writer. Why don't you take a writer or a journalist? You had good writers, she says. That's a good question, because Plato was a good one, but he's dead long time ago. Victor Hugo was a good one too, but he's dead also. And the journalists are making too much of sensationalism. We need you to report word for word what you are going to witness and to put the information in a book, and we'll help you to do that. She didn't tell me at that moment why they choose me, but we'll talk about that later. By the way, before to go further, I forgot to tell you something very important. You are all here in that room, that lecture. We are going to talk about astral body, astral travel, space travel, stars, Big Bang, and so on and so on. Thousands of books have been written on that. I am sorry, but all those books are theory, which is very good, like the theory also of Darwin's theory. You have a lot of theory, plenty of theory. It's all theory. But I am here not to tell you theories, not to tell you my opinion, what I think of it, what I think that we can talk philosophically after the lecture. But I am here to tell you the truth. Also in my book, it is the truth. And believe me, the truth sometimes doesn't please people. If you see a beautiful lady and you tell her, you are an ugly bitch, she is going to laugh at you. But if that poor lady is ugly and you tell her she's an ugly bitch, she's going to be very, very, very hurt, because that was the truth. So people sometimes don't like to hear the truth, and even here, maybe you can be hurt sometimes on my answer, because I have to tell you the truth. And for those who read my book, and so everything what is in, from the beginning to the end, I know some people have been hurt because things they thought, oh my God, I don't like to hear that. So after that, now we are going to continue the lecture. Okay, the abduction by itself, I know certain of you, you wanted to know how that did happen. So for me, of course, it's very, very boring because I've done that about 4,000 times. But certain of you, you like that part. Now, we are in a parallel universe. We are walking there, and we are going to an absolutely round spacecraft waiting for us there and shimmering, about levitating, about 10 meters over the ground, their ground, that parallel universe ground. And we went there, and then at that time, I have to tell you, I've been scared, because I say, that's it. It's no more a dream, because I pinch myself, say, oh, I'm not dreaming. She laughed at me, she said, yeah, you're not dreaming. We don't want you to think you're dreaming. So I knew I was not dreaming anymore. Even she could read my my mind like an open book. When I was thinking I was not going to see my family again, she just turned and said, no, you'll see your family very soon, Misha. How could she doing that? Because she was absolutely minor, you know. When I say she, it is because Tao, that extraterrestrial, looks exactly like a beautiful woman. But of course, huge, they can't even fit about the side of the inside of that stuff here. And very, very smiley, yeah, 10 feet high. It's a reason for that. It is because on their planet, you didn't read the book, eh? Not yet. I can pick everybody who didn't read the book. But, on their planet, the gravity is not like here, okay? Over there, I was 45 kilo instead of 70. So everything there is gigantic, okay? Like I say to her, if you read the book, why are you that size, you know? Normal size, I say. She said, no, it is a normal size for us, not for you, but what? Anyway, so that person, I say she, because she looks like a woman. Now, to be easier for the lecture, her name is Tao. Got a problem already. T-H-I-O. Tao. That's her name. You can pronounce whatever you want, but I pronounce it Tao. And she was my mentor from the beginning to the 9 day to the end of the 9 day. And you are going to ask me that later, so I tell you now. And she contacted me 2 more times, but only in astral and telepathically, since that's happened. Okay. Now we are both on that spacecraft, which was no porthole, no hole, no lidar, no little green man, I'm sorry for the science fiction people, but no lidar, and we levitate. She had this sort of apparatus, and she said, never touch me for a few seconds. She was very serious about it. I didn't understand why. It was maybe dangerous. And we simply levitate, and when I really thought I was going to bump in a spacecraft, a sort of piston went inside, and we land on a platform inside the spacecraft. And then I had a big problem with my eyes, because the colors inside were very, very strong, and I had to wear a mask, and she was telling me they were destroying my dangerous bacteria inside me, who was dangerous for them. In a calf, they were destroying it, cleaning me by the vibration, because for them they explain When it's a color is a vibration. And by vibration, you've got somebody behind you. And the colors are vibration. And the vibrations do a lot of things. Vibration can heal you and even kill you. But that is another story later. Now I am in a spacecraft. I'm not going to tell you all the stuff in a spacecraft. You can read it quietly for hours. And then we went to the planet named Tiaouba. Now, I'm sure about everybody in that room say the same thing wrong, because we don't understand. The physicist explained to us is the galaxy and the universe so big, stars and planets are light years from us. So how Michel Demarque can go in 9 days and 8 nights at the other side of the galaxy, at billions and billions of kilometers away, and came back in such time, even at the speed of light, which is more than 380,000 kilometers per second. And you are right, because it is impossible. Is it 380,000 kilometers per second? Pardon? Oh, yes, that's it. Thank you. The bad sense. So even there, you can't do that. And it's quick. Can't do that. So how did I do it? I didn't do anything. They make me doing it. Okay. Those people simply know how to transubstantiate. Maybe you never heard of the name. Don't worry, because I talked to scientists on that planet. They were interested in me. And they didn't really understand what it was either. So you have transubstantiation, which is not transformation. Everybody knows transformation. With, which means substance. Transubstantiation. I explained to you, it's very simple. That table, the building, us vibrate at the speed of light. If you have the technology to accelerate the vibration of this table or this bottle, whatever you want, take the table. You have the technology, take the board of accelerate the vibration. The board is going to disappear in front of you, that invisibility. Now, at that moment only, if you also have the technology, you can, when the board is invisible, transport that board on the moon, example. Just like that. Over there, you slow down the process, and the board reappears on the moon. That is transubstantiation. Believe me, those people do that with the entire spacecraft. We were 13 people aboard, 12 astronomers, if you want to call them astronomers, inside the spacecraft, plus me, and I didn't even feel it. But don't think it works like that. They go first at the speed of light, then they go in a space, and then very far away. Because if they do that, example, in our solar system, they blow up. Everything explodes. They would have a terrible accident. So they do that on the middle of space and reappear at the other end of the galaxy or wherever they want to reappear. But they re-slow down the process there. So finally, to tell you, if we talk about our time here on the planet, I spend about 16 of our time, our hours, in a spacecraft to go and to come back. 16 hours. Now when we arrive, I have to take Steve. See Steve? I'm terrible for that.
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah. You put... One minute. Later on. Later on, you're going to put that, that one when I tell you. And when I tell you, you continue. Is that one all right? Yeah, okay. Okay. So after all that time, and 16 hours, we didn't waste any time, because Tao told me lot of things. For those who read the book, I couldn't be absent very, very much, because it's a universal law. I could die to be on planet of different category. So they had to hurry up to give me information. So we didn't stop in a spacecraft full of information. Then finally we arrived at what I wanted to call Golden Planet, because I saw on a panel, it was all television panel, there's no porthole there, and we can see, and we saw a planet coming, which was their planet named Tiaouba. Now, I wanted to call the book the Golden Planet, because I'd call a chapter Golden Planet. It's a sort of golden mist around the planet, like you call the blue mountain here because you got a bluish mist, but that it was a golden mist. It's beautiful. Then we arrived there, and I saw that, so finally we saw Zoom, and we saw oceans, islands, like you, when you came with a plane on a planet, but very, very, very luminous. Then finally, steady, we land. And on the panel, I've been very, very, very surprised, but I wasn't surprised, and I saw half egg on the ground like that, all like that one, all like that. I said, what is that? You've got eggs, you don't have building on that planet. She said, it is our building. They are named on their language, Doko. Dokos with an S if you want to. Dokos, phonetically what they call them, Doko. And she said, no, Michel, they're not eggs. They are our building, they are force field. We build a force field, and we use it as a building for anything, the sun, the rain, the wind. And it was amazing. But she says, that's not important. As I said to the lady before, the importance here is the gravity. We are gigantic because we don't have the same gravity. You have two problems on our planet before we go out. The first is you are going to be unbalanced because on Earth you were 70 kilo, and with difference of gravity you are going to jump a bit and be about 45 kilo. The second is more important. We are going to give you a mask to cut 75%, 75% of the luminosity of our planet. It was terrible. The luminosity was very, very strong, and I could be blind. So they gave me a mask, and then finally we disembark, I can say. Then I got the shock of my life, of my ego. Because I say, oh my God, I'm an alien here. I'm going to have a red carpet, television, journalist, and all that. Why not? Nothing. Nobody. We were Tao and I. But I got a shock. My ego been hurt. I'm only joking. It's true, a bit. Okay. And we walk to what I call, and they call a lativok, but they call, I call that a flying platform. That's the shape it is. And you can sit down here, she sat down here. It's about 10 feet, 3 meters about diameter. She took an apparatus and we start to fly. Can I have the gravity stuff? It's one slide of gravity, anti-gravity. Is that my friend in the University of Melbourne prepare all those slides that I use them in each, we are going to make, yes, a little stop here and explain what it is. You know, a few months ago, finally, they make, some people, as you can read that, make an experiment in Finland. And as he say, my friend say all the time, many things happen by accident, many discoveries on Earth. And a few months ago, that experiment was, I don't know what for, that machine, and it was in a university over there at in Finland, Tampere. A guy came in the same room they were doing the machine and smoked a pipe. Finland, they smoke pipe, here they don't do that in university. Smoke a pipe, and everybody there was amazed because, and the smoke of the pipe went on the top of the machine, stuck on the ceiling. Very fast. You can tell me the smoke go like that, but not fast like that. Shoo. That's funny. So the guy, you know this funny? Huh? Everybody say, same thing bizarre here. So they went on the floor, on the top of that, over the machine, and they've done the same thing, and the smoke went up for many floors, and a building. Imagine that. So they suddenly look at a machine, and as you can read, that machine was making anti-gravity. It's the beginning of the discovery, anti-gravitation. Anti-gravitation, by the way, my friend went to San Francisco, Tom Schalko, who put something on the back of that book. He's a lecturer at the University of Melbourne. He went there and he told to a physicist in San Francisco, in the middle of the traffic, he regret to do that, he was scared. He told him what I told him, which to have an anti-gravity and no weight on this planet, you have the alpha ray making us weight like that. The alpha ray, if you send alpha ray against alpha ray, then you are weightless. And when he say that to that guy who is searching for 15 years about that, that scientist on the traffic almost got an accident. He say, what? And that was because I tell to Tom. So we are very hoping that guy maybe is going to make really the anti-gravity on this planet and make it work, because it's very, very interesting. I board on that platform, and you imagine when you heard, immediately it reminded me when I was there, you know, when you kid you heard about the magic carpet flying, it's exactly that. It's exactly that. Which is sometimes coming from legend, because those extraterrestrials were coming here 10,000 years ago, whatever. So it's exactly like if you imagine flying carpet. You go there, it's almost no noise, and the platform went up, and Tao could move it, and we went 500 meters away, just like that, sliding. And we went in the first doco. The first doco was on a landing place, if you like. They'll call it for not airport, because it's not an airport, but air base for their spacecraft. And I had a second surprise of my life, or I can say maybe the 10th already. But when we went there, we passed, we went straight inside the first big doco. Remember the doco? Inside it was, of course, the base of those people commanding the airfield. And we went inside. So the doco from outside is a whitish color, whitish, like an egg. Then the surprise was we passed through, you can feel something, it's no door. You pass through the force field. You just feel something, like a pressure, and it's finished. Then the big surprise is, when you feel that, you look around you, is no more doco. You are outside. Imagine all that building disappear. You see everything outside. It's very simple explanation. You can't see inside, but when you are inside, they made it like that. You can see outside. It's incredible. Incredible because on the top of the doco, you can see they have a lot of big, beautiful birds. And suddenly, you can see the feet of the bird, which is on the top of the doco. And you think the bird is is just like that in the sky, you know. And the bird is resting on a doko. If the bird is too big, a very big bird, pass through, scare, and he start to fly, because he can pass through. Okay, now, we're not going to go too much on that, because we have a lot more important than that. That's only materialistic, and we are here mainly for the spirituality. We went after that to my doko, which was in an island on the middle of the ocean. They have a planet with one sun. It's a bit like us, and it's not, if you like. First of all, the colors are, you can call monochromatic. Instead to have colors like we have, everything is mixed up, the monochromatic, and everything seems to be lightened inside. Like you see a leaf of the tree, and you think the light is inside the leaf of the tree. Very difficult to explain, as I say, the book's very difficult, but it is absolutely magic and beautiful. The only problem I had was the luminosity. For our eyes, earthly people, the luminosity is too strong, and as I explained, I find it for the first time in my life, I find it because of the beauty of the color and luminosity one time. But I'm being much too fast. I want you to understand what I'm talking about. Now, first of all, we took the platform and we went to my doko. That's just what I tell you. But I have to tell you something. I've been surprised because I start to meet people there, a few people at the airspace, and everybody, first of all, looks like very, very happy, but everybody looks the same age, about 22, 23, the good age. So I was wondering, and of course Tao reading my mind all the time, say, yes, Michel, it looks like that because we prefer to look young, and we have a secret and the knowledge of regenerating ourselves at will.
Could you stop for a second?
We flew, as I tell you, we passed over the sea with always that flying platform. I saw beautiful bird. We passed through the forest and finally the ocean, and we went to what we call, she call, I call, my doko. It was a doko that, like that. By the way, everybody saw that doko we show at the beginning. Everybody understand that photograph have been, can you show the doko again? That photograph have been taken by NASA on the hidden face of the moon. I know in a hidden face of the moon is alien space, alien bases for very long time ago, for thousands of years. And it is very interesting because as you see, that photograph is by the NASA, the American. Yesterday on television, her name, Kerri-Anne, told me I should talk to NASA, by the way. If I had time, I could tell her that, because that's not me, that's NASA. It's very, very interesting, that photograph, because Tom find it, you know. Now they take it very secret, but at that time it was a leaking and somebody pinched that photograph, because it's exactly, almost exactly, what the doko looks, you know. You can see, like I told you there, the thing is like a half egg, okay? So I had my doko was like that, okay? Half egg this way. Huge, from here to the other end of the room there. Okay, the detail, you have them in a book. For inside what it is, you got a relaxation place and so on, even a mini swimming pool if you like. And they take, by the way, the water, it came from the air, they transform the air in water, they have tremendous technology. I was all the time amazed. But we were there for a little while when suddenly we heard laughing, etc. And all the crew from the spacecraft came and joined us. And I was amazed they didn't have a spacesuit anymore. They were all in robes. Everybody on that planet wear robes. Coming about middle of the legs, robes. And full of colors, different colors, all on wine like that. Very beautiful. Same time different to the neighbor, and same time almost the same. And I've been told, can I have the aura please? I've been told they wear those clothes because the clothes are match with their aura. I didn't quite understand that at that moment. So they all came and we were talking, having a bit of hydromel, as I explained what it is in the book. That drink they have, pretty good. The food is no good, but the drink good. And we had having a good time for a while, and I don't know how we... Oh yes, I remember now. They made levitate the glasses and everything, just like that. And I was open mouth, and as usual, and silently Tao herself say, oh, I'm going to show you something, but she knew what she was doing, of course, each time it was for a reason, you'll see later. And she started to levitate, you know, cross legs like that, and levitation. She levitated, she went right up on the top of the doko. So I was... And suddenly I look around me and nobody was looking at Tao. Everybody was looking at me having a very good time because I looked, of course, like an idiot. For them it was absolutely normal. And for me, because you heard about yogis levitating, yeah, but you never seen them. And I never seen them either. And when I saw that person levitating, I was very amazed. Okay, then everybody went and I went and I slept in that doko, and the next morning, Tao came to me and I had my bath and everything, and I had the suit they gave me, they built specially for my size, space suit, and she told me to not wearing it and she gave me a robe at my size. Then I had another surprise, I wear the robe and I almost fainted. I was almost like a drunk, like if you drink two bottles of wine for a few seconds. She said, don't worry, it'll be all right in a few moments. What's going on? She said, no, it's simple. It's very simple, Michel. We give you that robe, and we build that robe, and the color of the robe being match with your aura. Can you see the aura of that guy? It's the first photograph we can start to do a bit of same thing on this planet with the aura. It's the first step. Don't worry, it's not, unfortunately, it's not a very, very good photograph. First step, that one is a bit better. Yeah. So, she explained that to me and I was amazed. I didn't really understand what she was talking about. She said, Michel, if on your planet you could read the aura, not only see the aura, but read the aura, you would use less Panadol and less medication because you could use the aura to know to how to match the colors of your suit, example, your dress, whatever, your room, and you will be in much better health. But what is the aura? Many people still don't know what is the aura. The aura is simply... Okay, this is the first step, it's very, very bad photograph. But the aura is simply the emission of rays coming from the chakra. Here, you can see that guy got that chakra, which is on the top of the crown, his pineal gland. That chakra is a bouquet, we call. That's the second chakra. Here, third, the photograph has been moved here. Third, four, five, six, seven. Okay. Those chakras give an emission. We are going to talk about that a bit more later, because for the moment I want to be nice with you and give you quick something else. You're waiting for it, or you don't. That's what happened with the robe she gave me. I was so happy with that robe. Incredible. By the way, we got a little stop here to tell you, my friend in Melbourne at the university with interrogating me, asked me question about that famous robe, made that shirt. That shirt exists. By the way, I got it. I am not going to undress for you, but I got one here under my, and give me a lot of energy. Believe me, I can't sleep with it. That is with the chakra. We'll talk about it later. He've done that and of course made a photo montage and put that new cover, but this shirt is a sort of things working and working on this planet now with the chakra and the color. It's 14 different monochromatic color. But he's a scientist. He's done it. He's done it in Melbourne. Now, that's why that shirt is very brilliant here. But that's the work with the aura. Now, aura. Remember, I am in my doko. I wear my robe. I don't want to confuse you. I wear my robe. I'm so happy. She laughs again. Oh my God, she says, etc. And she tells me about the Panadol and all that stuff. And she says, now we have to hurry up because they're waiting for us. I say, who is waiting for us? I didn't dare to ask. And here we go. We embark on that platform, flying platform. And we went to the ocean again. And very, very fast, that platform can make a force field around it. You can't even feel the breeze. And we went to what she called the city of the nine doko, which is dokos like that, very big doko, this form. And we went there. Then we walk, and finally we stop on the front of a big doko. And then Tao, who is always, always very happy, very easygoing, was silently very serious. And I say, oh my God, why she changed like that, you know? It's very, very bizarre because she doesn't laugh anymore, she doesn't joke. And she said, Michelle, I'm going to, she's sort of stopping just like that on the front of the doko. And she says, no door at the doko, but you have a light where you can cross, like that you don't bump on something behind because you can't see. So that's what it is. And she stopped there and she sort of concentrate. She said, you are going to close your eyes for the luminosity. I'm going to take your mask off and we are going to come in. I was very intrigued. And I've done what she said. She took my mask off. And I felt she lead me by the shoulder. Of course, she's like that, so she take my shoulder like a kid. And we walk, my eyes closed. I could feel the force field of the doko. And I knew we were in, but I was very, very intrigued, see what's going on here. And we walk, and finally she said, you can open your eyes now. I opened my eyes, and you have to remember that. And I saw what I thought it was, 7 statues on front of me in a sort of semicircle on the front of the doko. Everybody can hear me there? It's okay? Thank you. You have to tell me because with my accent and everything, and if you want to come on the front, it's okay? And...
to hear and to see better on this side and hear better on that side.
Yeah. You want to come here?
I see it's green.
Oh, yeah. I can't go there. Because I want to show you a lot of things. But if you want to come here, it's good. Because it's more work here than there. There it's almost finished. And I look at there, and it was 7 statues. All wearing the famous robes, all sitting on different color seats, all also with different colors, very important. And I was wondering what I was doing there, because also I wasn't sure if they were statues. And they were not. They were the 7 masters of the planet. nothing to do with John Howard, he's not a politician. He's not the master anyway. But seven masters of the planet, and seven on seven seats, of course, and sitting like you imagine Buddha on a lotus position. So I was, of course, absolutely speechless, because they were staring at me with their eyes, you can say, luminous. It was very, very weird. You could swear their eyes inside were luminous. So you imagine that? Since I am about 12 years old, nobody could impress me. Maybe for that they choose me, those people, I don't know. Nobody. And for once in my life, I swear to you, they impress me. That's it. For once in my life, I shut up for 2 hours. I couldn't even speak because they read my mind and give me the answer before I open my mouth. But I'm being too fast again. I'm sorry for that. So, the middle one, they greet me. I remember they greet me. And they say, the spirit will be with you. The other one in echo says, the spirit will be with you. And then they never talk anymore. But the center figure start to levitating and came to me. In levitation, remember when I told you Tao levitated when on the top of the doko? She'd done that because she wanted to show me what it was, the levitation. Because if she wouldn't show me before, when that guy was levitating and coming straight to me, I would do, you know, ah! And over there, even there, they are very, very great master, and you have to respect them. Tao have, everybody there have great respect for those one. They are almost like gods, if you like, you are going to see. So he came to me, levitating. Instinctively, I closed my eyes, he came over me, put his fingers, imagine they have a huge hand. After that, Tao told me, he put one finger like that, one finger like that. I close my eyes and I smell a sort of incense, a smoke inside me. Impossible to explain. And he leave me. So I opened my eyes and I saw him going, but he changed a lot. He was in fire. Everything was burning and I almost yelled. Tao immediately sent me a telepathic message. Yes, Michel, you can see the aura for a moment. I was seeing the aura. And I look at Tao, she was burning. And believe me, they have a tremendous aura. So when people on this planet tell you about aura they never seen in their life, now you are going to hear about it, and you are going to see some people are cheating you. Okay, that photograph there, of course, it's a very nice photograph, but we don't have the technology yet. But the aura, some people in a psychic expo tell you, ah, this little bra, it's a little aura like that around you. The aura is not like that. The aura, I always have problem with my stuff everywhere I go. I don't know why, maybe my karma. That's supposed to be a human being, if I can make that working. One day, is it? No, that's good. That's the legs and etc. So we've got our famous chakras, we'll talk about it. The aura is like that. Non-stop, okay? Here you've got the bouquet, forget about that. The aura is doing like flames. That flame in 2 seconds later is here, and there, and there. It's like a fire. You put fire to somebody. Pardon?
Flares.
Yeah.
Flares.
Yes. Yes, flare. Non-stop. It's burning. Why was that? Because the aura is the result of the actions of the chakras. A chakra sends emission, and that makes the aura. So that if you know how to see the aura and you know how to read the aura, then you can go to the source, which is the chakra, I'm sorry, and the chakra act on your glands. We'll talk about it later. For the moment, I was absolutely amazed. Very difficult for me, because, oh my God, I didn't know what to think. So one thing, the main thing I could see through the doko, all the doko was invited with that, was the pink color. And I learned later, the pink color is the color of love. So I can tell you something, they are very, very loving people, because all around the seven figures, it was pink, 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 pink everywhere. Plus, of course, a lot of gold, which after that I learned is spirituality, and purple, that everything was golden around them anyway. Now, same thing is very, very important now. They were sitting on those seven seats, and you could see them in front of me, same time, almost became invisible and reappearing, okay? And it has been told later to me, they had a very big problem. Those masters are so high spiritually, they don't live on physical. They had big problem all the time to keep their physical body around their astral body. I hope you know what I'm talking about. But if you don't, you are going to know in a few minutes anyway. So they were trying to keep their physical body around their astral body inside. So same time they were disappearing. After a little while, the center figure started to talk to me, because also, I forgot to tell you another thing. I would prefer to be naked in front of you now than the situation I was there at that moment. For the simple reason, I say, I am seeing the aura, and I heard in my life, if you can really read an aura, you can see if the person have bad thoughts or jokish thoughts or dirty thoughts. So I didn't have dirty thoughts or anything, but you never have pure thoughts. So I said, they can read all my thoughts, because they can read my aura better than I can do anything, because I just see aura, I don't know what's going on. They can read my mind. So I was absolutely naked and very, very impressed. And I said, but what am I doing here? I said to myself. I even not finished thinking about that. Finally, the center figure, that one who came to touch me, greet me again and say, Michel, we didn't bring you here with all the trouble it's doing, because you don't travel through space just like you take the plane from Cove Harbor. Here, just to visit the planet and to admire our planet, which we know already you like very much. You're not here as a tourist, you're here because you have a job to do, like Tao already told you. And he continued to speak and to tell me what's going on. So, first of all, they are watching us, those people, for hundreds of thousands of years. Time to time, they give us a little push, a little help. And now we are at, everybody knows, pretty critical turn on this planet for many, many different reasons. Not only because we rubbish it physically, but also they are appalled, totally appalled, the way we act more materialistically all the time and not at all spiritually. Which doesn't mean you have to meditate all the day and go in the Himalayas, not like that. But it means we are spiritual beings, wanted having a physical experience, but we forget completely about who are we really inside. Then I was a bit lost. And at that moment, I didn't expect him to tell me that, even after everything Tao explained me during the trip. I'm sorry. What's happened? He said, I'm going to light you immediately and give you explanation. Why are we, he say, in that physical body? Why all that? Why the planet? Why everything? All those famous questions we ask ourselves for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. So he start to say, Michel, at the beginning, before the Big Bang, famous Big Bang, was a spirit. It reminds me of the Bible, and that in my mind. So he said, yes, it reminds you. Before anything was a spirit. You can call it the spirit, you can call it God, you can call it the creator, that depends the terminology you want. Nothing to do with religion anyway. That was before the Big Bang. The spirit, if you want to call it the spirit, say, was no sensation, because it's pure spirit, no sensation. So the spirit say, okay, I'm going to create an instrument to give me physical sensation. I want to feel sensation for my pleasure. So the spirit imagine us, a humanoid form each time. That humanoid form, which is a human being, if you want, like that, same planet, a bit different, but always humanoid form, will be an instrument, physical instrument, says the spirit, to put myself in it. Myself in it. Difficult to understand that. What that? The spirit. Yeah, but what is the spirit? Many people tell you that. What is God? Who is God? Is he married? Does he have a big beard? Who is God? Who is the creator? Who is everybody? Who is the, what is the spirit? Wind. Nothing. Nothing. You can't see it. It's wind. But it is a spirit. Everybody believes it's a spirit. No, it's not. It is something. It is an immense. Forget about thinking about it, we can't think with our, that immense electronic, everybody on this century now know what is an electronic because you watch television, electronic mass on the center of the universe, but that electronic mass, full of electrons, yeah, billion, 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 is the spirit. And the spirit say, I will put few of my electrons in that instrument, and those electrons will send me a part of myself, if you like. Which is very good, because if you remember the Bible, God created us at his image. And of course we mixed up everything. We say, oh, his image, so God, he got a big beard. Of course, for the primitive people, you couldn't tell them, oh yes, it's electronics, this is what he's talking about. So you need a picture, and you make God with a big beard. This is nice, nothing wrong with that. But here, we are very, very serious about that business. We're talking about that very great intelligence put a little part, are you to see that, of his electron inside our physical body. But we've got a little problem there, not me, but God. He doesn't want any, or it doesn't want any bad thoughts, bad sensation. He wants only pure stuff. It's a bit if you put a big saucepan full of oil, you put it on the stove, you boil it, and then, don't do that, never do that. My boy in Africa have done that one time, as an explosion. And you put a bit of water, pow! And it's exactly the same thing. God doesn't want that, it would hurt. So, he wants to imagine a barrier between it and us. Nine different categories of higher self, that will be later, we talk about reincarnation, acting as filters for the sensation between the poor fellow human being we are here, through the higher self, and send only good thoughts, good sensation to God. Okay, we're not going to talk about all those filters and stuff like that because it's boring, it's much too complicated, but we are going to talk about something everybody, if they don't know, you are going to know, and if you know, you maybe don't know, but you feel it. It is your own higher self. What is a higher self? I should have two or three boards, like sometimes I have. What is a higher self? Everybody's talking, and New Age people, they talk, oh, higher self. A lot of people think they know what it is, and some don't. So we're going to talk about it. The higher self is simply also electronic. Now, I'm going to stop that 2 seconds to tell you something. Everybody heard, mainly in religion, etc., about the soul, as I said 2 minutes ago, the spirit, same body call it astral body, and if you call it spirit or soul, even in religion they say, yes, that's wind, there is nothing, it's just a spirit. I've got the news for you this evening, this afternoon. Inside your physical body, what certain call soul, certain call spirit, certain, I prefer astral body, because it's the shape of our body. In this astral body, your soul if you like, you have not nothing or wind, but you have more than 4 billion trillion, imagine, of electrons. And each electron is able to memorize the whole books in Canberra Library, National Library. Imagine the possibility of memorizing. That, of course, is absolutely immortal, coming from God, disappearing when you die. It's your real self, it is your astral body. That astral body is made, of course, of 2 parts, one conscious, one subconscious or unconscious. Subconscious is a better term, where everybody tell you, the doctor, psychologist, oh, it's in your subconscious. Subconscious is a word, I give you the detail, it is, yes, in your electrons, in your subconscious. Your brain being only a computer. All the memories are there, from reincarnation to reincarnation. When you die, that astral body go back to the higher self. But this time I've gone again, that's my problem symptom. Too far, too fast, sorry. Okay, every day now with the new technology the doctors have in the hospital, and more and more and more near-death experience people talk about near-death experience. You heard about that? Huh? A lot of people. Very interesting. After my lectures, oh, a long time ago, I don't know, 2 years ago, so, in the Gold Coast, a young lady, she's about 23, she said, I heard about you, I'm going to tell you something. Okay. We went talk, and she said, you know, I had a car accident, and they say I was dead. And I said, oh yeah, I heard about that, I know about that, but people have different reactions. Did you see, some people say, I saw Jesus Christ. I said, did you see Jesus Christ? And she said, no, because I talk too much. I should let her speak. She said, Jesus, no. I said, did you see Buddha? And some people say Buddha. She said, no. I said, did you hear music? She said, no. I said, so finally, what did you say? And she said, oh no, it's very simple. I've been there and whoosh, I went through a tunnel and I went in a big light, very, very big light, full of love. And I said, oh my God, what I'm doing here, please, please, my boyfriend needs me. Can I go back? And here I am, I'm talking to you. Oh, good, good. And I say, oh, it's simple, you saw your higher self. My higher self, what's that? So that girl didn't read books, didn't know anything at all. She never read about anything. She couldn't try to, you know, take my attention, fool me, do something. She was absolutely sincere. She didn't know what she was talking about. And she gave exactly the same description many books give, like the Dr. Moody took many, many witnesses about that. Exactly. even if people tell you about Jesus Christ, sometimes it's their imagination. She said, no, I saw a silhouette, but if it's Catholic, it's Jesus Christ, another one say Buddha. They didn't see anything. They see the light, and they came back, and we, like a dream, if you like. When you came back in a dream, sometimes you deform the dream at your will. So that girl didn't know anything. She said, just saw a light full of love, I came back. The highest self. She said, what? What's that? And I explained to her what it was, the higher self. And I'm going to explain to you, of course, in detail, because it's very, very, very important for you. It's very important for many reasons. It's a reason sometimes I make a joke about it, and you are going to relax with the joke, but it's true. If a guy who never heard of higher self, he die, go to the, because I die for good, eh? Not just with the accident. Die, he's dead, he's on the bed there, and he go up, straight up to that light. He say, oh! Never heard of it. He's scared to death. He's dead already. He's scared, came back. He came back like a boomerang to his physical body. Then he's next to the physical body. And he see himself on a bed, and his wife is crying or laughing because maybe she wants to go with the neighbor. That's my joke. And, oh my God, he said to his wife, hey, what are you doing? What's happening? What am I doing here? The wife can't answer, the children either. Nobody can answer because he's in astral. But he can see himself in astral. See himself, the astral body, electronic body. And he can see his physical body, doesn't understand anything at all. So he panic, he ask, he say, hey, I'm here, what are you doing with my body? I'm here. What is that, you know, etc. Big argument. He turn around the house, and as a second joke, sometimes he see his wife giving his own car to his brother-in-law, you know. So he's very upset. He says, that's my car. You know? So he got a problem. He got a problem for 3 days, the guy. He's suffering for nothing because he doesn't know what is there. Because the astral body turned around the dead physical body for 3 days. So he's going there. He sees the light again. Damn scared. Came back. Turned around the house. Talked to everybody. Nobody wants to answer. So it's very good. People know that before anything happened in their life. And they know. It's very good when I talk about it. Because it's nothing to be scared of. We are going now to talk about the higher self, that famous light. Now we are going to talk. That was joke without be joke, because that's for 3 days. Do you remember when Jesus Christ been resurrected? They didn't tell you 4 days, they didn't tell you 2 days, because it's a reason for that, because it is 72 hours. After 72 hours, the astral body go completely with the higher self. If the guy like it or he doesn't matter, because that's a universal law, it is the nature, and he goes there like you are attracted by a magnet and he's finished. But between that, he can go around. Now, all that is explained in the book. But I wanted to tell you that. Now, I'm going to ask you a question before, later you are going to ask me a question, and now I'm going to ask you a question. Anybody in this room had déjà vu? Oh, a few. You never had a déjà vu? You know what is a déjà vu?
I think I have had once.
Haven't seen. So please put your hand up if you had. Don't be shy. Oh, that's better. Okay. Thank you very much. So, what is a déjà vu? Many people tell you, oh yes, I believe in reincarnation. It's my former life. Yeah, I saw that and that. No, I'm sorry, it's not true. Okay. Don't worry about the déjà vu. We're going to talk about it again. Explanation of the déjà vu. The higher self is an electronic mass also, of course, coming from the top. But the higher self is simply... in religion they call that a guardian angel, okay? But it's not quite like that. On the category of planet we are here, a higher self got 9 times 4 billion trillions of electrons. You know those billion trillions of electrons which make an astral body? nine times that, plus a nucleus of 9 × 4 billion trillion of electrons for its own energy. Which means that the real higher self here, then 9 times those 9 astral body to distribute in one physical body here, one in New York example, one in Tokyo, one on planet Mars, one, no, that was a joke, one on the moon, good. So you had one there, or two in Sydney, one in Melbourne, whatever. Nobody knows, except you can have, because people call about soulmate, and that's true. If really, really you have a soulmate, you can come from the same higher self. It's very difficult to know, except one we are sure of is the identical twins. The identical twins are from the same higher self. And you know, as well as I know, you don't need me to tell you that, is one identical twin is in Sydney, got an accident, physically, really, a shock happened to the other identical twins in New York or Paris. So, why? Because it acts like a walkie-talkie, boom, boom, going to the higher self and talking or giving sensation to that one in New York. That is sure. That was the higher self. So the higher self distribute the astral body inside of 9 different physical bodies on the planet, which now we are all here, and but all of us have 8 different brother and sister, if you like to call it like that, but astral speaking, 8 different other people on the planet, home, its own higher self. Okay, anyway, later we talk about it if you didn't understand. Now, how does it work? How do you came here? How do you, ah, yes, I'm baby, ah, yeah, baby, yeah, but how does it work? How, because the baby, the physical body, all that, forget about it. That's all nothing. That's physical. What is important on all the stuff is the astral part, all those electrons, which is us. I hope now you start to understand what we're talking about, because we are that astral coming from there, those famous little electrons to send sensation, little electrons, 4 billion trillion each of us. But for here is nothing, it's a drop. We are that part of God, if you like, that is inside us. I am my astral body. I shouldn't, it's difficult, we don't have the terminology for that. I shouldn't say my astral body, I should say me. Example, I don't know your name, so I have to take back me. Me, Michel Jean-Paul Demarquet, doesn't exist, by the way. No, 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 I don't exist like that. Me, astral body, talking to you is nothing like Michel Jean-Paul Demarquet. I baptize Michel Jean-Paul Demarquet, that physical body, but I am, of course you are, an entity going from reincarnation to reincarnation, and in this life, I call it Michel Demarquet, maybe the last life was Napoleon. You know what I mean? He's nothing like Napoleon, he's nothing like Michel Demarquet, he's nothing like Paul, Peter, or whatever, but it is that entity choosing a physical body, exactly like you choose your car in a street. This is a very good comparison. You choose a car, you jump in a car, you drive the car. And when it's finished, the car is completely rotten, you go out of the car, you let rot the car to the wrecker, and that is your body going to the cemetery. You don't make a lot of fuss of that, do you? So we make a lot of fuss, because we say, oh, my friend died, the friend didn't die at all, he's just there. Anyway, I'm going too fast again. I hope you follow me. But that is the astral body. And that astral body, me, example, I use my physical body for the moment, because I lost already being in that vehicle, that car. I lost my ability to communicate to you telepathically, just by thoughts, because I am trapped in that physical body. and you lost yours too, because if we were all in astral here, I would do like that, and you would do exactly the same, and we watch each other, and every thought of mine, you absorb them, and I absorb yours. We don't even speak. And those people on that planet, Yauba, they don't have a pen, they don't have a paper, they don't have a book. If they want to learn something from somebody between them, they talk. Oh yes, they talk because they have physical body. But if they want to learn, they know how to do it. They just go like that, and they watch each other. You can say in 10 seconds, they absorb information of 10,000 words without talking. That great things, that real stuff, because they are very, very, very evolved. They use their physical body, not like us. If they want, they can die by will. They say, okay, I leave my physical body and go away and let the physical body like that. But that is a bit too complicated. I explained that in another book, because I notice more and more and more when I talk to people, they need more explanation. But for the moment, as I say, I go too fast, and I'm very, very sorry for that. I'm taken. And I want you to follow. Now, what's happened when, because the astral body is on another plane, the astral plane, same time for 1,000 years, 2,000 years, 15,000 years. And suddenly, that astral body, by, it's very complicated, you can't explain that, have a urge to rejoin his higher self, and then with the help of the higher self, call it the guardian angel if you like, see what they can learn in taking a new car, a new physical body. Then the higher self, listen to that now, we are going to talk about the deja vu, the higher self help that part of itself, which is that astral body example of Michel, say, okay, I'm going to show you a scenario of a life you can have on the planet Earth. And it shows a scenario. Be careful when I say scenario, because it's just a scenario. You can change many things. It's not compulsory to do it. First of all, you have a free will. So we are going to compare, because to make you understand, you have to compare with things we know. If I put here a screen and put a video, and very, very fast I show you your next life. You want it or not? You look and you see, oh, and I will meet Michel Demarque, oh yes, that's funny. And I see that, and I, oh yes, those people, yeah, I can choose them, like my parents, my brother and sister, wife, blah, blah, blah. Oh, I go in a boat, blah, blah. Oh yeah, I take it. No, I don't want it. But it's not just like that, of course, it's much more profound. You look at that and you can see with the help of your higher self, you see, yes, I can learn something I didn't learn before, learn something to improve my knowledge, spiritually speaking. Then you can choose it or not. Same time, it's very, very hard life, but you know you can do it to advance very, very fast and finish to ending to the source, maybe in 10,000 years or maybe in 10,000 days, nobody knows. Then you know you are going to learn something, choosing that sort of video type, you see, I see, okay. And obviously all of us here say yes, then okay, you choose that. It's finished. Same thing happened there, and everything you saw is erased, and you don't remember anything. It's a reason for that, for suicide purposes, because you could be tempted to do suicide, which is very bad. And also, the main reason is, if you know what's going to happen tomorrow morning, you are going to avoid it, and you're not going to listen, to learn the lesson. Good. So for that it's arised. But in the nature, everything got a little accident. And same time, the movie you saw haven't been arised properly. Then for 5-10 seconds, it happened to me for 1.5 minutes in my life. You say, oh my God, I saw that before, I saw that. That is a deja vu, because a little piece of the video haven't been erased, and it is the part in this life. Believe me, I went in Atlanta, in America, in 95 to launch my book there, and I had plenty deja vu. I was sick of it. I don't like Atlanta, and no wonder I had deja vu, because maybe my electron, I don't know, it was sensing in, and I had plenty deja vu. I was very, very uneasy with that, and I hope nobody could have so many bad deja vu like that. But it is, a deja vu is not a memories of a past life, it's just a bit of your movie which is not arise properly. Good, you got that one. Eh? Well, that is now before to came in the womb of your mother. So you choose everything now, okay? Then, of course, you came inside the womb of your mother, and you choose your mother, choose your father. Contrarily as the people thought long time ago, they say, oh, we don't choose our parents. It's absolutely false. We choose our parents. That's absolutely false. Now we've got those people who was born. We talk already about the death. And later, you can ask, of course, plenty questions, because it's so many things about to talk about. But I have different things to tell you. Because that, okay, our purpose on earth to please the Great Spirit, we are, I would say, without being rude to God, but we are a bit trapped by his fault, because he wants sensation, he created us, but it is like that. What do you want to do? It's like that. We are a part of the mechanism. We are also, you know that, a part of, because, oh, by the way, when God imagined the man, he imagined the planet, imagined everything, and suddenly one day he triggered the biggest atomic explosion that ever happened in the universe, which was the Big Bang. Okay? So the famous Big Bang, I wrote my book and published in 1993, 2 years after the scientists said, oh, by the way, the Big Bang is not a theory anymore. You know, we know, you know. Thank you very much. They didn't read my book, but they discovered it by itself. So, but I say that before, because as I tell you at the beginning of that lecture, I don't say theory. Now, there's a lot of differencing also. They are going to learn, the scientists. We are going to talk about it now. Continent of Mu. You don't think we are really the first civilization on Earth. Of course you don't. And you are right. What we can call civilization, because for those people, they don't call really the civilization, but I don't want to be too bad with it. Now over there we've got a very nice picture my friend found and put that on the slide. And it is the Pacific Ocean, and we are going to talk about the ancient civilization. Pacific Ocean, so you don't need me to explain, the picture says it all. But a very long time ago, it was, for those who read my books, that big continent arose 1 million years ago in the Pacific. And now it's not there anymore, because it disappeared. But it was a big continent going about next to the California there, touching by Zoom, going Hawaii, a bit like that, and like that. Huge continent, but 3-4 times like Australia, and one corner of that continent, one corner, was the quarry of Olathun. And on that quarry, they were cutting stones, statues, and everything. That continent, what is that continent? Inhabited by whom? By a very, very, very evolved race of people, coming also from another planet, planet Aremo X3, if I remember well, and they were very evolved. At that time, they were the most evolved people on the planet Earth. They knew about levitation. They knew about the anti-gravitation, the law of anti-gravitation, and very important, they were friends of people of Tiaouba. Not only friends, but people of Tiaouba were visiting the King of Mu in Savanasa with their spacecraft openly, which I wish they would do, like that I wouldn't look like a liar or like a cuckoo when they interrogate me on television or even on the street, because when you say to your neighbor, been abducted by aliens, they try that over the fence. He thinks you're cuckoo. So I say to Tao, why don't you do that now? Go to the Pentagon and like that, it's a bureau. No, you're not ready yet, she said. At that time, they were ready and they were talking openly with the government, those people who abducted. Being gigantic like they are, being very friendly, very nice people, the artist on the continent of Mu asked the king if they could, by stylized statue, make statue on memories of those people coming by spacecraft. And the king accepted. And they've done lot of statue on the quarry of Olathe. Now what's happened when the continent went down the water? It's happened then one on 10 part. The quarry was 10 times bigger than Easter Island now. And it was no Easter Island. That was, you understood that already. That was a quarry, 10 times bigger than Easter Island. And now it became Easter Island because everything sank under the water. The scientists can go down there, find plenty statues they want to. And the statue you find on Easter Island, even many scientists are, my God, how, where they came, what for? They were simply ready to go and to be shipped and put all over the continent. I saw them in Psychosphere. We'll talk about that later. So, the statue you see now in Easter Island are the remnant of the statues they were doing and shifting. Now, how can I have Easter Island statue? Also, something very interesting. If you look in an encyclopedia, you got 7 statues. Yeah, that one, that's good. Okay, by the way, it's a guy, I forgot his name. Everybody heard about him. He went, he done with the Kon-Tiki, he crossed the Atlantic.
Thor
Heidel. Yeah, Thor Heidel, a name like that, I think. He speaks French, by the way, the guy. And he's very nice. He wants, you know, to prove his theory, so he put about 200 people with a rope, and he moved a statue about like that, and the statue moved and went, you know. But if I, you know, knew him, and if I could talk to him, I would ask him, because his theory, it's with a rope. So I would ask him to move this statue. You know that guy here? That's the nose of the statue, is that the head? That statue about 150 tons, and that statue is inside the crater. So it would be very much fun to see that statue moving, okay? Okay, so thank you for laughing. Now, that is because those people didn't take rope at all. They had the secret, as we are going to see, of anti-gravitation, and they could move, as I say, everything is weightless, okay? And they can move, as we are going to see, tons and tons and tons with an apparatus like that, because it's a vibrational stuff. I don't know how to make it, nobody yet. But it is like that because as Tao moves that platform, as we flew, for those who read the book, that's anti-gravitation complete, and the way to use it. Now, those people, yeah, it is very interesting to see also, I didn't notice that, but excuse me, Tom, the seventh one, Tom made my friend put that slide, and if you remember, I told you the seven master of the planet, and there in Easter Island, you've got seven statues like that. Very interesting. But that is normal. For me, it's normal. It's interesting for you, but because I know what's happened, okay? Seven statues. Okay, of course, it doesn't look like my people because it's stylized. Those sculptures are very difficult. Stylized statue. But it looks like them because it's gigantic. Okay. Now, that's for Easter Island, but that great civilization of people, very great civilization of people, civilized about all the planet. Same went by South America and civilized through the Amazon and passed through and civilized and went to Atlantis. Atlantis went in Greece and Greece in Egypt. And the other one went by Burma, by and finally India, and went to Egypt too by the east. Those people had so great civilization, they could speak. They could speak with other planet from the planet Earth. So some people here say, what is he talking about? He lost his marble. Okay. On this planet now, you have our government, sorry, our scientists tell you every day, nothing like UFO, nothing like extraterrestrial, you're making a big mistake. Forget about it, it's nothing, all those things, no extraterrestrial. But every day they spend millions and millions of dollars to send radio signal through the space. Because they say it is somebody there, maybe he can answer. And listen to that one now. They say, oh, we are going to send a radio signal, and they build a machine, and they send the radio signal. Hello, we are here, planet Earth. Hello, how are you? Then they send that at the speed of the gentleman, say, whatever, 300,000 kilometers per second with speed of light. But still it's too slow. So 10 or 20 years after, they receive an answer from another planet. Oh, we are well, thank you very much. What about you? So you can't have a conversation like that, do you? No, it's impossible. So what is faster than the speed of light? What is immediate? Thank you very much. Aha! Thank you very much. So it is a thought. So, what are you going to do? Oh, I'm going to telepath. Good. And you start to telepath. It's good. So you telepath in Mars, Venus, whatever. A bit even further. But you are a poor human being. You are in a physical body like that. Even with your astral body, you don't have enough energy to go to the end or the end of the galaxy. I'm sorry if somebody thinks the contrary, but it is what it is. And you don't have enough strength, the pyramid please, enough strength to communicate very far in a galaxy. Then those people of Mu, they had a knowledge and they knew how to build. Don't worry, that one is from Cheops. But on the continent of Mu, before the destruction, 14,500 years ago, they had the knowledge from their planet and they built the pyramid. Be very, very careful, everybody here, of what I say. I didn't say the pyramids. I am talking about the pyramid of Cheops for the moment, but in Mu, that continent, they had a pyramid three times bigger than that, but exactly the same scale. You know what I mean by scale, if that one is 100 meters, the other one was 300 meters, 200 like that, she was 600, whatever. The exact dimension is very important and the orientation. Why? Because the pyramid is made a certain way to make inside the you call that the chamber of the king or king of chamber, king chamber, thank you, over there, a sort of zero magnetism. It's a tremendous magnetic field, and that pyramid is built to give to the user over there the absolute strength to send thoughts through the galaxy by that place. Then our very good scientists call it an air shaft. It's not an air shaft. That one is not an air shaft. And nobody, of course, could find a mummy here because it never been any mummies there, and it will never be, because even in a sarcophage, they were lying alive, meditating, and sending thoughts. Now, it's something very important. It's so much force, magnetic field on that pyramid. First of all, as many people don't know that, in each lecture I ask, if somebody know it, just telling me, it's forbidden to any plane on a planet to pass on the top of the pyramid, because it's the Great Pyramid, because it is very dangerous, because by magnetism everything electric and electronic stop. For a few seconds it can be very dangerous, so it's forbidden. The second thing, inside the pyramid, people tell you, example, oh, I spend a night, or I can spend 15 days in a pyramid. That's a lie, because you die, because you can't do that. And I heard so many stuff like that since I came back. And I was in Phoenix, Arizona, in the United States of America. I was talking about on the radio, 3 hours on the radio. Fortunately, it was plenty of advertising. I had a cup of coffee. And between a break, the journalist said to me, I've been with 7 of friends, we went in a Great Pyramid, we spent the night. I said to myself, that's it, another liar, you can't spend a night in a Great Pyramid, from what I know. But he was not lying, he said to me, and the next morning we were sick like dogs. I said, that's become interesting. He told me they were with, what do you call it? Tape recorders, camera, everything being erased, and they were very, very disappointed because of the magnetic field inside the Great Pyramid. So that Great Pyramid was, I'm talking about Mu, but of course the Great Pyramid, now we're talking about that one, is a cosmic tool. You can contact different galaxies for the user who knows how to use by telepathy, can contact worlds very, very far away and have a conversation, telepathic conversation at the other side of the galaxy. That is the great explanation of the Great Pyramid. Now, can I have the photograph of the Great Pyramid? Now, how did they build the Great Pyramid? Oh yes, by the way, we are going to talk to stop and a bit on that subject and do something very interesting also, of course, for everybody. I don't know if people yesterday saw me on television and Kerry-Anne said, do you have any proof? Do you have any proof? But I missed for about 1 minute. In 1 minute I could tell her. I was telling her the proof are in a book. Because, in a book. Because, as I said before, when I was with Tao, the first thing I said to Tao, nobody's going to believe me. I hope you give me, you know, a piece of metal or some shit. She said, no, we don't give you anything because you're very good to disprove on Earth. If we give you a proof, even a piece of metal, any scientist can say, oh, yes, that metal doesn't exist on the planet Earth, but maybe he got a secret alchemist who's done the metal for him. So they won't believe you anyway. But she didn't tell me. I was wondering why she make me put all those information about pyramids, life on Mars. You remember the life on Mars on the first chapter? Maybe the first chapter, the second chapter. It's just a few lines I explained who were the people on Mars, what they were eating, and they were life on Mars about 1,345,000 years ago. And I was wondering when I write the book, why always talking about that, the Great Pyramid, and so on and so on, and sort of secret revelation on stuff we talk and talk and talk about it on Earth all the time. And now I understand that what I wanted to say to Kern, I understand very well why, because every day, the proof I wanted became reality in my book. Not in a book, the proof are in a book because, example, nobody believed life on Mars. And now if you watch the television or whatever, our scientists say, oh, we found fossils, certainly it was life on Mars, it's maybe still life on Mars, etc., etc. So every day I laugh because, as a joke, I say, open my book, read it and talk. You know, because now they discover things I put in a book. I'm very happy. Now, the second thing is much more spectacular for people like skeptic, of course, nothing wrong to be skeptic, but people like Kerian, example, to talk about here, say, okay, you sure it's more spectacular to see if it's true or not. If, like she seemed to think, I was inventing the book. I'm a landscaper architect, I'm not a scientist first, but if I was tremendous imagination, then inventing the whole book, I could say, listen, everybody, because it's been thousands of books written on the Great Pyramid, with all different theory. I could say, oh listen, all those guys, they talk about 4,000 years old, the Great Pyramid, 4,000, maybe 5,000. If I do something, I could put 5,500 years, you know, to be not like those. 6,000 years? I can't go further, it's ridiculous, it's a mistake. But it is very, very funny because you are going to read what I put in my book. In 93, can I have a photograph of the last? Yeah, go for it, it must be next. Yeah, that's it. That's what is in my book. Great Pyramid of Cheops, constructed by Thoth, not Cheops. Everybody tell you it's Cheops. Because they thought it was at the time of Cheops, yes. The Cheops used it. So now, 17,000 years ago, I'm a stupid idiot because I should, it's impossible. Why do I jump like that? I don't jump, I don't care. I say what they told me. So now, 17,000 years ago, and if you read the last news, the, how do you call that? The guy who dig.
Archaeologist.
Oh, thank you. The archaeologist, and they dig and they look also at the Sphinx, and you know that, they understood not long ago with the erosion and so on and so on, oh my God, the Sphinx and the Great Pyramid is maybe 12,500 years, not more, 4,000. And plus, and I laugh and I say, go 4,000 more. That's it, you'll be right. I am laughing and that is proof. That is proof because they are going to finally find out it is 17,000. I know that. So what about that? That's what very interesting. And okay, now we are going to talk about something else. They still don't believe on it, but they will soon. Still cosmic. The stone of 50 tons. Remember to move the statue and all that stuff. And that is simply what I say here because by the way, in a Great Pyramid, can I have the schema of the Great Pyramid, the drawer? Yes, that one. I'm going to tell you something. You don't know that. You see up there, I tried to get it there. That here is one stone inside. Nobody knows that. That here, that's one stone. Yeah, people know that, but I mean, you have to know it too, here. You know that stone? The Rialto in Melbourne, that's the size of the Rialto. You want to move that with a bunch of slaves and whatever you want. 2,000 slaves, 10,000 slaves, 100,000 slaves, you can't do anything there. And that is the anti-gravitation. They have the secret of anti-gravitation and they can move. Also, you have to understand the Great Pyramid. Did you think 2 minutes or even 2 seconds if you want, or 2 hours? As I told you, that what they call the air shaft is directed on a special place in a galaxy to talk and to send thoughts to precise place they knew in different planet in a galaxy. Okay. So you can see, as I can see, to direct that shaft in a galaxy, it would be pretty easy if you build a pyramid, then you pierce, you know, you look like that and you know where to go and you say, okay, I'm going to pierce, you know, sharp in two. But it doesn't work like that. They build the pyramid and as long as they bring the stone, the architects, the sharp is made. So you imagine the tremendous knowledge for an architect to put the pyramid at that place and for the building of the stone and the cutting of the stone too. It's incredible. You can't absolutely even imagine that with our so-called technology now. Now, I don't want to hurt your ego about so-called technology, so-called civilization, but too bad. You know, I'm going to tell you something. We are very proud on that planet Earth, not me, but certain people are, of the space shuttle. You want me to tell you what is a space shuttle compared to their spacecraft? Their spacecraft is the Concorde and the space shuttle is the Wheelbarrow. It's exactly the same thing. You compare Wheelbarrow and the space shuttle. The Wheelbarrow you can put a bit of money, you go there. And the Concorde, you can go wherever you want, around the Earth, you know, it's the difference. Eh? And it is exactly the same difference. So as long as we use rockets to put spacecraft, if we want to go on another planet, you want. Now, also another thing, don't worry. I never said that on my lecture, by the way, before, but maybe at the early beginning, 2 years ago. If by accident or not accident we discover the way of anti-gravitation, transubstantiation, and we have the ability, possibility to visit other planets, those people are not going to let us do that. They are going to stop us even by violence because they judge for the moment we are not able to look after our own backyard, as you know, because we pollute everything, and they're not going to let us going on another planet to pollute a second one in the universe. Now, at that time, as I say always, there's so many things to explain, so many things to talk, so many information that book, and same time, I think I just touch the top of the iceberg and I forget maybe a few lot of subjects or detail, and I ask the people here to be free to begin to ask any, absolutely don't be shy, any question they want to ask. So here we go. I'm here. Yes, sir.
The search for extraterrestrial intelligence, listening to radio waves and things. It's being done on a large scale at the moment. But a scientist called Fermi, I think it was 20 years or so ago, formulated what's now known as Fermi's paradox. That is that he feels that the galaxy should be teeming with life, and yet we are not aware of it, not perceiving it in a physical sense. And so do you have any comments to make on that?
I didn't quite understand what you say about that scientist. He says the galaxy would be what?
Teeming, full of life.
Oh, yes, but I say that all the evening, that of course it's full of life. We have plenty planets inhabited in the galaxy. Mm. You read my book, didn't you? No.
I've read half your book.
Aha! And you didn't read the whole.
But tomorrow, I think
pick another one. Yeah. Okay, you read chapter 12 tomorrow. And you shouldn't go to chapter 12 directly, but you'll see it is a lot of different. Yes, very good, your question. Very, very excellent. Thank you. I just didn't understand what you wanted to me to tell you. Excellent. I can. Don't worry, don't be impatient. But yes, because we have a lot, of course, lot of planet are inhabited, but also different environment and different form of human being. But always humanoid. But you can have a form of certain planet, chapter 12, with a reptilian skin or a small person like that, another one bigger. The proof is with those people who are gigantic. Same, I saw alien, and I let you the surprise in chapter 12, which were about perfectly built like us, miniature, like that. That's their size, you know, in one planet, I don't know which one, but it is in our galaxy also, you know. Have a different planet inhabit. Now, science fiction like to show you monsters and things like that. it's not only a good question, but it makes me think, I forgot about to tell you something. Some people like that explanation on that. I never talked about it before. And finally, we're going to talk about the gray alien. Finally, Tao told me in Atlanta, Georgia, send me a telepathic message, give me the order to talk about it, and I talk about it. I almost broke the table, I was very angry, and it was a UFO room over there, and I almost broke the table. Because in front of me, they told me, oh, they're not very attentive in America. I said, not attentive, they are going to be attentive with me. I said, there's so much noise. Yeah, I was in America, and suddenly I said, my God, what's going on here? It's 5 million of American people who really are sure they've been implanted by the gray alien. Then Tao sent me a telepathic message. Okay, go for it. So then I say that, and first of all, I told them the Roswell crash was true. It was 6 alien in Roswell crash, 5 died, 1 being kept alive for a while. Good. Secondly, people talk about gray and make photograph or design of ugly, like I say, science fiction. It is a bit true because all poor people are very ugly. But I saw ugly one in chapter 12. I don't tell you where, it's a chapter. And those ones called gray, I can't tell you exactly where they are because it's still forbidden for me, but they exist, good. But they're absolutely not dangerous like people think. First of all, it has been 100 to 150 people implanted by the gray alien on this planet. No more than that, not 5 million. So you say, why 5 million people? Because it is a collective hallucination. You remember, I don't know if you remember, in a book, you had, at the beginning, in a book, Tao told me about hallucination they can make, and how it easy to hallucinate or illusionate people, and that's what can happen. And she even hallucinate or illusionate me and making the entire spacecraft blowing up. Good. Now, people have collective hallucination in America. Now, why the gray alien are having, they have a problem. That's happened, they can have. Why is the gray alien having implanted about 100 to 150 earthly people. It's simple. Since 1948, with radiation, atomic radiation, which is very bad atomic radiation, we on this planet lose steady our immune system. For that, we can be very, very angry against people like Mururoa, French people, or making atomic tests, because very bad. So the atomic radiation make us losing steady our immune system. Those people, those gray aliens, know that. Know we are losing steady. So they are on their planet almost completely dying by lack of immune system. So what's happened, they are very interested to see how we are going to react on that matter. So what's happened, they implant very, very, very tiny, of course, stuff inside of few people, but they are not in command of those people. They are just using that like a camera under the water, if you like, you know, to a living laboratory. But they're not endangering those people. So I know it's a bit difficult to understand, but it is like that. And they're not going to invite us. Also, for many of the extraterrestrial, people think, oh, we are going to be invited, you know. You have to imagine something. You have to understand something very interesting. People who came here with, because it is a lot of rubbish about UFO, but it's still true stuff. Like 98% of sightings are mistake or people who want attention or blah, blah, blah. But it's still 2% of real spacecraft coming from different planets, visit us, observing us, repair the spacecraft, so on and so on. Of course, but not like people think it's it. Okay, those people, anyone they are, any who they are, have a tremendous technology already to come here and visit us, because we can do the same thing there. So imagine those people, they came and look at us, and they say, oh my God, what a mess, because you have to admit, we make a lot of mess around. They say, oh, maybe we think you got beautiful building or machinery, they laugh. And you know what they do? Same time they look at us like we go on a monkey's cage and look at the zoo. Do you want to sleep and live with a monkey in a zoo? No, they don't. I'm sorry if I hurt you. But they look at us like that and they say, hello, bye-bye, see you later. Yeah? And you're not going to be invited. But the story of the alien, the gray alien, are exactly like I told you. I hope everybody understood that one. It is just, they are dying by lack of immune system, and they are interested in seeing if they can have, learn something from us, because we're not dying yet, but we steady losing our immune system. They want to know how we are going to get out of it to copy us, maybe a bit. The lady, you had a question.
Yes, I was going to ask the people that you visited.
Pardon? They have what?
Healing property?
Yeah. They have more than that, yeah. They regenerate their cells at will.
But for us, do they help us at all?
They help us. Time to time they give a little push, of course. This time they want me to wake you up. They took me physically because, I'm going to tell you something. Thank you for that question. Very good question. Don't think I'm going to avoid any answer or anything like that. So if I do so, you ask again. I had to do that. But same time, I'm carrying. Now, what do I want to say? So those people abducted me physically for a very, very simple reason, because I think, I thought about that light. Everything I saw, everything happening to me, is so extraordinary. If it was by astral, you know, by astral travel with their help, I am a skeptic myself. If you read my book in chapter 11, when I touch a body there, I don't give you I don't spoil the book for you, I don't tell you which body. I feel ashamed myself, I wanted to touch, because I am a skeptic. So I would, if I didn't go there physically, I would never believe what I saw myself. I would say all my life, ah, come on, it was a dream. It was a dream, a good dream. Same time a bit bizarre, but a dream, it's impossible, okay? But I was there, I've been there physically, I even came back with a bruise. When I came back, I slept for 36 hours, and I've been there, I eat there. By the way, I prefer the Australian food or any food than them, but this is another story. I bath there, I even swim there in the little mini swimming pool you can call, Roman bath, if you want to call it like that. And I breathe there, everything I've done there, like I'm doing here, even things you think about it, you know? So everything you do when you are with your physical body. And I disappear from my home for 9 days. But so I tell you that if I haven't been there physically, I wouldn't believe what I saw. So that's to answer your question, because they've done that to take me there, to make me witness, really witness it, to come back, to report that to you, and of course for the detail I didn't remember, and they helped me telepathically for the detail in a book. Did I answer your question? Yeah. Yes, gentlemen.
How can we go?
You've got the white cab or the red and white? What sort of taxi do you have here? You jump in it and you transubstantiate. Okay, I am joking. But if you are a good astral traveler, you could maybe contact Tao by astral and go there by astral. If you are really master of astral travel. Now I am answering seriously. It was a very good question.
Has anybody else done it besides you?
Ah, that one I told you before. Please remind me. Thank you very much. C'est Victor, your name. Good. Do you remember when Tao say, sort of, shut up and do what I want, because she's like that? And she said, you are going to make a trip. Nobody, not at least at this century. Okay. When my book went out in 93, and finally people start to read it, a friend of my good friend came and one day and said, I give you a present. Brought me a book. What that? In French, the Book of Enoch. Anybody heard about that? Yes, yes, yes. Somebody? Yeah? Yeah? Oh. Book? Ah, thank you, thank you. Book of Enoch. You read it?
I don't heard that.
I didn't even look the name. But it's a Book of Enoch.
Yes,
I hope he pick everything well in a book. Like, so I say, you want me to read the Bible? It's very nice, the Bible, I love it, but I already read it. He said, no, read it, read it, read it. It's an apocryph of the Bible. They don't want it in a Bible, but it's written a bit like the Bible. Enoch was, if you read it, you remember how many, 4,000 years ago? 5,000 years, he was a patriarch. Yeah, between Noah or something. The guy report in that book, in his own terminology, you know what he report? Don't you think it's a big resemblance? Did you read my book?
Yes, I have.
The Doko, that's the Crystal Palace. The angels, they all fly over there with that apparatus. If you read my book in chapter 12, when I tried to fly myself, and Tao say, look behind Latyonusi, he got wings. I saw the wings. She illusionized me. She hallucinated me. Black one. He can sell the golden one if he wants to. Enoch, I mean, Enoch in his own terminology, I am almost sure, was abducted by those people at that moment, being there and came back and write that book. That was what I wanted to tell you. Very interesting. Don't you think so?
Of course, sir.
Read it again. Read the two books, that one and Enoch, and you see. Many, many, many resemblance. Very interesting. So I said to my friend, aha, now I understand. Why you give me that book?
I have a question myself, if you have finished.
Hey, go
for
it.
Here. I would imagine then on the planet, on the ninth planet, the composition of the air would be so different to the composition of the air on Earth. But I
not so much.
I take it that you were able to breathe the air.
Yeah. Mm. Not so much at all. The main thing, of course, the air is absolutely pure and so on. The main amazing things are, of course, the different gravity that can happen on many planets, more or less. But the main thing is, and also different animals, but the main thing is the colors and the luminosity. Absolutely, if we have, as I say in the book, if we have 20 shades of red over there, they've got 150 example, you know. It's incredible. It's a joy for the eyes. And of course, being vibration, I understand why they are in good health. Sorry. Any other question? Yes. I go with you too. Yeah?
With the star system.
Pardon?
With the star system in your book, I haven't read it. But
you haven't read it?
Yeah, I bought it today. Thank goodness. And I wanted to ask you a question about Sirius.
Sirius?
The double star. I was wondering if you had any...
I don't know.
All right.
It's very rare when I say I don't know in my lecture, but you know, I went there through that spacecraft. I remember I saw Saturn, because maybe they've done that. They passed next to Saturn to show me something beautiful. We were 6 million kilometers away, but it was spectacular. I don't know if they done it on purpose, but I don't know. Like I know they are next to the Pleiadian star, but I can't tell you, oh yes, that's Tiaouba there, you know. Even you can't see it, because if you remember when I was on Tiaouba, I couldn't see Earth at naked eye because too small.
Did
Chapter 11.
Did you give any information whatsoever about any of the solar system or galaxy stars or anything like that?
No. That's more scientific. I am a bit repeating like a galah what I saw and what they told me to tell you, you know. Ladies?
I was wondering, are we the only planet in the universe?
Pardon?
Are we the only planet in the universe that's destroying ourselves? Or is there other planets like us?
In our category of planet, because they are by category, we are very low, of course, category, but which is nothing to do with... No, unfortunately, it's different planets who've done the same mistake. Also different, obviously you haven't read the book, because a planet also destroys themselves with atomic destruction. You will read that in chapter 3. But as far as environment damage we're doing, no, we're not the only one. But generally, it's happened on planet of our category, because people are very low level. We are very low level. But it's not because we are low level we should be sort of ashamed or, you know, or feel guilty or something. Don't get me wrong. It is the... Do you think a child of 5 years old is ashamed to be in a kindergarten? No, it would be ridiculous. It's exactly the same thing. We are in a kindergarten. We are, but that's us to us to do something and to, you know, okay, and talk like we're doing now. It's okay, it's all right, but we are exactly at the place where we have to do. We have to do something. We have to start by... We are on the lowest category level planet, which means the environment around us is very hard, is very harsh. I should explain that to you much better about the category of planet, by the way. They are the ninth category. And if you read my book, you say, oh my God, oh, that dear lady here, she's, oh my God, you're lucky to be there. And she's right, many people tell me that, because it's like a paradise over there. Because on that high category level, the environment of the planet by itself is different of our environment. Like we said before, the air is like crystal, is no pollution, they don't have disease, etc., etc. I give you a few childish example. Example, if you go in North Queensland where I live, you go in a grass barefoot and you hurt yourself immediately with, yeah, I will be with you. You hurt yourself immediately walking on sensitive plant, which name exactly Mimosa pudica. That plant is doing that when you touch it. It's full of sounds and you hurt yourself. Why is that? Where the nature done that? It shouldn't be like that. Why do you take a rose, you smell the beautiful rose, you hurt yourself with thorns, you know what I mean? And it is, we have to learn this way, you know? Why do you have malaria, cancer, AIDS? It seems terrible. Some people say, God, it's terrible. No. It has been, by nature, done like that. Because that's the way we have to learn, very, very hard way, on that category level. And if we don't have the same environment, exactly like in a university, you don't have the same environment that you have in a kindergarten. Not the same toilet, not the same eating, you have your parents to look after you, you don't have the same stuff, everybody knows that, you know. But that's the same stuff. That's what I mean when I talk about category of planet and level of planet. Yes, sir.
Yeah, when you showed that picture of the moon,
mm-hmm.
I may have misread it, but I thought I saw copyright 1959.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's the guy who find that, I don't know where.
1959. Taken from the moon.
The NASA got that photograph from the hidden face of the moon. I don't know how they got it.
Were they on there?
What?
On the moon.
Uh-huh. Of
well,
course.
As far as I remember, I thought Armstrong was the first person to go there.
Yeah, that's what
you that's what I thought.
Yeah. I thought so too.
So how come?
Armstrong?
Yeah, well, I was always of that persuasion.
No.
No?
When we're talking about the photograph,
yeah.
It is not a person like Armstrong going and photograph. It is when they have a satellite around the moon and took photographs there. Satellite. Not a person going with a camera on the moon. No. They were sending, like, exactly like now, they send something on Mars or Jupiter or whatever. The same stuff happened at that time on the moon.
Right, so that photograph was taken from
like that, the same way.
Before
1959. Maybe a lot before, you know what
right.
I mean?
Yeah. Now that other one you showed of the pyramids on Mars,
mm-hmm.
The photograph of the big face, which really interests me, was that photograph a computer-enhanced photograph?
Was it
a computer-enhanced photograph?
I don't know. You should ask my the guy who gave me the slide, my friend in Melbourne. But I am sure, you know, everybody shows that photograph in every newspaper.
Well, I've seen the photograph many times.
Yeah.
I've just always been...
You were maybe skeptic?
No.
I'm not telling you skeptic about me, but skeptic about the guy who took the photograph, maybe.
No, I'm not even skeptical about that.
Oh, good.
But I am skeptical about his computer enhancement, because as far as I can see, and this is why I'm asking, the computer enhancement just consists of doing a mirror image
of
the one that's seen.
Yeah.
And you get this thing that purports to be a great big face.
Yeah.
Really interesting.
No, you're right. I'm sorry if I can't give you more because I'm not good on computer, I'm not good on anything. But for me, of course, I know what is on Mars.
Yeah.
And I can tell you all those photographs, you'll see more about a lot of things because it is something on Mars.
Yeah.
I mean, it's no body there anymore.
Uh-huh.
Oh, no. Mars cooled down. In every solar system, you have, many solar systems, you have very often only one planet inhabited at a time. And after the hundreds and thousands and millions of years, that planet cooled down, but this, nobody can live anymore. But example, to give you an example, if the Earth cooled down and Venus at the same time cooled down, and Venus became inhabited, you can go on Venus, you know what I mean? Okay, that's what's happened, because Martian came very, very long time ago on Earth. Yeah?
Yeah, about your higher selves and the individuals, do the people on the other planet Teoba have higher selves as well?
Ah, good question.
Do the higher selves...
Yeah, the highest, good. On the higher you go on category of planet, lesser you have the higher self distribute body, which in another world, each person on Teoba have his or her own higher self. The higher self give only to one person instead of nine body. But, very good question of course also, the higher self, very good question, we have to emphasize on that. See, it's terrible, I lost a lot of things. The higher self is omnipresent, omnipotent. It means, of course you understood already, if you have a person in New York who got the same higher self you have here, and the higher self of the same person, your higher self is has the possibility to help that person there and to help you here. So, if you like, it's a bit like people say Sai Baba can be at 10 places at the same time. It's exactly the same thing. Now, when we talk about higher self, please be free to ask everything you want from your higher self, pray your higher self. And that is a mistake is made all the time since century, because we've been conditioned with belief, religion, and so on and so on and so on. Everybody say, oh my God, pray God, and etc. Et very good, yeah, you can pray God. I'm going to ask you a question. Now I ask a question.
In relationship to what you just said,
I ask a question. Do you know in Australia the Minister of the Education?
Vanstone.
Amanda Vanstone,
yeah. Good. Personally?
No, thank you.
I got you there. I caught you. Stop. I'm a naughty boy. You don't know him or her personally? Okay. Few people here go to the school, or Sunday school, whatever, or Sunday school, the evening school for adults. Raise your hand. Anybody? No? Nobody go to learn something? Who? You? You? You don't know anybody? Okay. You know your teacher? Do you know your teacher? Yeah. He's a teacher. Teacher is here like I am with you. You know me, you have a direct contact. But you don't know the Minister of Education, do you? You don't give a damn anyway. I'm sorry to make that comparison, but God is the Minister of Education. Yeah, he's responsible, but he's there. But your higher self is your teacher. Your higher self is just next to you like your teacher. And you can contact your higher self. By the way, the easy stuff to be very, very quick if you have to really ask something very important to your higher self, is simply to cross in your bed your 2 feet like that and to cross your hand. Again and again, the religion is very good, but sometimes they don't know what they're talking about. They tell you to do that. It's a long time ago, they forgot about why. Because if you do that and that, everything is electricity between your higher self and you, the astral body, the physical body, the brain, everything electric. And if you do that, you close the electric circuit and then you have more strength to contact your higher self. And then you can pray for good. And loud voice ask him for a parking spot on the street. You kidding? I can have any parking spot, and I got witness in that room.
I want just with my higher self. I don't do that. I yell after him in French. I say, I want a, it's true. But anyway, that is a sort of joke because it's not very important. But you can call for healing, for problem you have. Now, not only you can call, but by the way, your higher self is looking after you day after day, minute after minute. And we are going to talk, I'm with you, but we are going to talk very, very, very important subject here. Thank you very much to ask that question. Who asked that question of myself? I forgot. You, thank you very, very much, because I forgot to talk about that. The suicide business, okay. Everybody's interested in suicide business. Do you know, is absolutely no rubbish what is in behind that book, that guy who say, this book saved my life. I was ready to commit suicide. Thank you, Michel. I was in Cairns in front of my bank, and I knew, because I know people who recognize me on the street. He talked to me, and I said, like, if I didn't hear, and I opened my car, and the guy came, and I said, oh, okay, okay. And he said, you are Michel, aren't you? You wrote the book. I say, oh, yeah. I say, okay. You don't remember me, I was in Brisbane at your lecture at the university, so blah, blah. And, good. Is you all right? He said, yes. No, I just want to thank you very much. I say, yes, for what? He did to write the book. I say, okay, yeah, that's my pleasure, it's my job, you know. And he said, but it's more than that. And he came to me and like that, and he said, I was going to commit suicide, and just at that moment, I start to read your book, and I wouldn't be here if I didn't read your book. Okay, so I became very touched, of course, and I shake his hand here. You all right? You remember when I told you your higher self show you the video, and he show you the video for all your life, and your higher self erase everything and you forget everything. You would like to know, like I do, everybody want to know, what's happened tomorrow morning, when are you going to die? Ha ha! Maybe in 10 minutes, maybe in 2 minutes, maybe in 10 years, you don't know. Maybe he erase everything, but he knows. Your higher self knows exactly the year, the month, the day, the minute, and the second you are going to die. No. But when you say, yes, I will be Michel Demarque, you sign a contract, chuk-chuk, and there's no signature like that, but it's worse than a contract. That's it. You make a contract with your higher self, which is a part of yourself, and it's finished. If you break the contract by committing suicide, and you can, because we have, by the will of God, we have our free will. If you break the contract, he knows, and he's going to be not happy at all, and you have to reincarnate in 49 days, which is absolutely ridiculous, because it is a waste of time.
Are you talking about suicide?
I'm talking. Your higher self here is going never break the contract. Your higher self never ever break the contract, and your higher self say, I know he must die at 99 years, 2 months, 3 weeks, 2 hours and 5 seconds, and he makes sure you go there. He's protecting you. For that in religion they call it guardian angel. Your higher self is protecting you. Your higher self is looking after you all the time. The famous story I give in a book when I say the taxi is broken, the guy go to the airport, take another taxi is broken. It's happened. You can read that in newspaper. And people say, oh my God, was lucky. Lord, what a coincidence. No coincidence. It was all the higher self. The higher self can make the taxi break up. The higher self, you heard about Jesus Christ, miracle. The higher self can do every miracle Jesus Christ was doing on physical world. For that, if you read the Bible, it's good stuff in the Bible. Jesus Christ himself said, everything I do, you can do it yourself. He said that. So why do you say, no, he was Jesus Christ, I'm not Jesus Christ. No, he said,
Why did he want to say that? He said that because he was doing effectively what we can do with the astral body and physical body and so on and so on and so on. It was an excellent question. So please try to hold, don't commit suicide, because it's a big waste of time. Example, I have to die in 2 hours, okay? Then I'm so unhappy, I commit suicide now. It's ridiculous, I'm going to reborn again and spend the 9 months in my mother's womb and blah, 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 and I will be a baby called death. I will die after 2 hours when I will be dead. And for that, babies dying very, very young, they are generally. You know, it's very complicated. Don't take me like to tell you the future, all that stuff, because it's very, very complicated. Everything in reincarnation is between your higher self and yourself. Nobody can know, and it is very, very, very complicated story, that story of reincarnation. I mean, complicated, complex each time for each individual. And by the way, I'm thinking about that, individuality, you have everybody. If we are 5 billion people on this planet, we are 5 billion, of course, of different astral body, having a different experience, a different learning. And I got a proof of that for Marie Kerrien. She like proof. Everybody like proof. I get a proof for that. Can you deny, anybody in this room deny, if we are 5 billion and 500 million people on this planet, we don't have 5 billion and 500 different fingerprints? You wouldn't dare to deny that, because everybody has a different fingerprints. And you know why? Because the higher self, the higher self and the astral body itself is building that fingerprints like an identity. And that is a sign, physical sign, of what I say, spiritually we are 5 billion absolutely different people. Same looks alike, but they're not, because we have a different goal, each person has a different goal. We approach to the end of my lecture, but I think I had a lady who asked me another question there. No? No? Finish?
No, I think I understand.
Finish? Finish? Finish?
Does the higher self have a higher self?
Pardon?
Does the higher self have a higher self?
The higher self is a higher self? No, it doesn't look like that yet.
The higher self a body as well, or is it only the 9 or 7 bodies?
I didn't understand that one.
You know, like you've got 7 bodies or 9 bodies,
mm-hmm.
you know, which are connected to the higher self.
Mm-hmm.
Well, can the higher self be a person as well?
Oh, no, we can, no and yes. Because the higher self sometimes send the energy, it's electronic, okay? So send the energy. I got a lady, she told me she was killed, she saw her mother during the night going to the toilet, and my mother was sick. Next morning she said, who was with you? It was a lady behind you holding you. So that was the higher self. But it was the form, it was a shape of a person for the kid, for the person who is you. Same time people, so to answer to your question, if you like, the higher self is not like we think a physical, but same time he envelops us and takes the shape of our body. Yes, it can. Also, same time people during my lecture, I don't know if anybody saw it here today, I don't know. But same time people see big sort of form next to me, it did happen a few times. And a lady, I don't want to embarrass her, and she's in this room today for the moment, and she told me yesterday evening I was talking to her, facing her on the sofa, and she said, you don't feel anything? I said, no. She said, it's a very huge form behind you. I said, oh, for me, it's not really my higher self, that's a guide. I got 3 guides, you can have 3, 4, 5, everybody got guide. That's too long to explain. It's nothing, it's very nice entity in astral helping you, you know? It's nothing to, don't dream about ghosts or stuff like that. It's absolutely natural. Yes, madam? Don't go too fast. I'm not too very intelligent.
Obviously, spiritualism is the main message.
The main message.
Yes. Are people gradually changing, and have you been told to use other methods than what you are with your seminars to show people?
To show people?
Are you just instructed to do seminars and your book? Have you been instructed to do anything else?
Oh, no, 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 I don't instruct you to do anything. My book is, have you read the book?
No, I haven't.
No, no, okay, okay.
Where are we on the road to spiritualism? Where?
No, well, good. I try to answer your question. I'm going to try to answer your question. I don't give really a trick to do anything. The point is here, okay. Example. People ask me that example. So look after just the spirituality, so we don't have to work anymore, okay? We can go to the door and meditate all the day. That's absolutely false, because first of all, we are not, as I said before, a physical people who want to go and look after spirituality. We are spiritual people who took the form of this physical body to have a physical experience. But many times we forget about that. That's my message, their message. Now, we forget about it. But you have a physical body. That physical body, enjoy it. If you have $10 million in a bank, $100 million, whatever, they're good for you. It's perfect, and go for it. But the problem is, if you focus 24 hours per day on your 20, 100, or whatever million dollars, and you don't look inside yourself, never ever, and say, oh no, then you are wrong. You will die, be the richest woman or man in a cemetery, and the poorest in reincarnation. You will reincarnate in 49 days, and the trick in reincarnation is not to reincarnate. That was my answer. Now, I can't teach you, but I suggest people meditate and get in contact with their higher self and feel themselves as their real self inside themselves, the real astral body, contact. And by meditation, it's very good to time, know where they came from and where they go, because finally to understand, you are exactly like the driver in a car. You know, you are inside your physical body. You use the physical body as an instrument to have a knowledge of something, and that's the beauty of it. We don't know what. For that is no good to go to the fortune teller. Because if you remember, before to come in that physical body, you knew at that time what to learn, that everything been a rise, and now every day is an adventure. So the best things to do during that adventure is to make the best of it. And I think that will finish my lecture for this evening. Yes.
My question, Michel, goes back to the guardian angel. Being said by psychic persons that there are guiding spirits around us.
Pardon? I can't hear.
Guiders, like guiding spirits around us. And intuition meant to come from them.
Intuition?
Intuition, yeah.
Oh, yes, but we can talk a long time for the intuition. But the higher self is helping you all the time, give you intuition and stopping you doing that. But as I said before, you have to pray the higher self to have same time a bit of help. You know, some people feel a bit lost, you know, they get totally lost. For that, many religion make a fortune, because people go together and somebody says something and they're not lost anymore. But religion are good for some people, because that helps them. Religion is a congregation of people together, like we are here, we can help each other. It's nothing really wrong. Religion is bad if religion is brainwash people, or give, that's a very important thing, thank you. Also the fear. Religion is bad for fear, because religion wants the power, and tell you, be careful, you've got the devil, you've got Satan. Satan doesn't exist, hell doesn't exist, the devil doesn't exist, is nothing to be feared on anything on your life, anywhere. You don't have to be feared. Don't be scared of anything. It's a waste of time, and you can't be scared of anything. It's ridiculous. Don't be scared. You're scared of what? To be killed? Or be scared, it's going to be hurt. Don't scare of any kid. If you kill me now, I bless you, because I know what's going on the other side. And I didn't commit suicide, so I am big bargain there. You want to shoot?
Michel,
question.
I wanted to just know whether there is any difference.
You want me to smile?
Whether there is any difference between the actual guiding spirits around us, two or three, human to be, and the higher self.
Yeah, the guides, they work hand in hand, if you like, with the higher self. The guides are entities, but you don't really know who are they. I don't. I never seen faces, I saw forms very time to time, and I can feel them, they give you also energy, but mainly the higher self give you energy. In few of my lectures in the summer, I will bear arms on the Gold Coast, and one day, it was so funny, a lady was like that. I said, oh my God, yeah, I'm going to have a problem, she's going to, she doesn't like me, she's going to insult me or something. So I say, is it same thing? It was 120 people on the marquee, and I was playing with a chair. I didn't have a table. I say, she must be there or no with that chair. So I say, is it a problem, lady? She say, you are blue, she say. Everybody look. And I didn't know what to say, you know. And I say, oh yeah, as long as I'm not red, you know. And I continue my lecture, and another girl who saw the same thing there told me it was people coming 20 minutes late, and she said, you remember those people? She told me another day. She said, yes, you became angry. I said, yes, I've never done that before in my lecture. I said, you know, it's not good for other people. It's not fair. You should be in time. I was very angry. And she said, and I saw all your arm here became red, and your face became red. I said that to that lady for a joke. I said, to get rid of her, I said, as long as I'm not red. And that one said, ah, what's going to happen now? It's becoming red, it's becoming red. And I didn't know that story. And one day she told me that story, and we laughed about it, and I told her what I tell you, I didn't know. But that's to tell you, and few people saw me very, very blue. Okay, that's to answer to your question. And what is that blue? Simply, my higher self say, oh my God, he's tired, the end of the lecture. And he's there, because he's there, no problem. And yours is there too, by the way. And whew, send me full of energy, a good energy, and then it's so much energy, it came with my electron, more energy, my electrons start to vibrate, and you can see a blue light. That's what it is.
Now, if the higher self is higher self and all these are a sort of educational facility of the universe that individuals access. Now, if we are a less stupid planet than the planet Tilda, we need...
We're not stupid!
Or less evolved.
Yeah.
Only we need more one-to-one tutoring, whereas on Tilda they've got one-to-one tutoring.
Yeah.
And we've got only 9-to-1.
Oh, that's not my fault, it's like that. It's not a matter, I think, of quantity, you know. It's not. Not like, it's like that by nature. I tell you what I learned, that's all. You have to ask Tao.
You've got to establish a structure.
Yeah. I'm very tired, and I think we've got about 3 hours or something like that. And I thank you very, very, very much to come at my lecture. And if you want, by the way, I have to tell you the truth. In each of my lectures, you see, I never prepare. The only thing I prepare to be not too chaotic, I say abduction, Bermuda, what? I don't know what even is that. Oh, go aboard the spacecraft, transubstantiation, Tiahuba, Doko, Aura, Master, Moon, Pyramid, and after that the question. So I never prepare, because if you go in Paris and you see the Arc de Triomphe, I'm not going to prepare to tell people that I remember everything, many, many, many things. So I never prepared. So what's happened with Christian everything, each of my, I got a guy in on the Gold Coast, the guy is 6 foot something, you can't miss him, okay? He's from UFO people, he got the thing, he came at each of my lectures. So one day I was sick of that, and I said, excuse me. He said, yes. He said, aren't you bored? You came at about 16 of my lecture. And he said, no. I said, what do you mean? He said, each time I came, I learned something new. I tell you that because people told me that. I don't know how I do that. I say, really? I thought I repeat always the same thing, you know. But it's interesting because people ask questions. Then I say, oh yes, I forgot that one. And for that, each time is different, of course. Sometimes I make fun, sometimes not so very good because I'm too tired. Today I was not too bad. Thank you very, very much. I think I felt your love. There's a lot of loving people this evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
No, don't applaud. But it's okay. Thank you very much. A special one, eh?
Well, you're very special.
No, I say special.
And I think that planet is, and everything, oh yes. Beautiful. And we'll meet again in spirit.
You want me to write that?
A few nice words, please.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
The 9th.
Yeah.
August. Okay, thank you very much, Michael.
It's been
very nice to meet you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Me too. Thank you very much.
Wow.
So
for him to go,
or
to go to the
but all those books are theory, which is very good, like the theory also of Darwin's theory. You have a lot of theory, plenty of theory. It's all theory. But I am here not to tell you theories, not to tell you my opinion, what I think of it, what I think that we can talk philosophically after the lecture. But I am here to tell you the truth. Also in my book, it is the truth. And believe me, the truth sometimes doesn't please people. If you see a beautiful lady and you tell her, you are an ugly bitch, she is going to laugh at you. But if that poor lady is ugly and you tell her she's an ugly bitch, she's going to be very, very, very hurt, because that was the truth. So people sometimes don't like to hear the truth, and even here, maybe you can be hurt sometime on my answer, because I have to tell you the truth. And for those who read my book, and so everything what is in, from the beginning to the end, I know some people have been hurt because things they thought, oh my God, I don't like to hear that. So after that, now we are going to continue the lecture. Okay, the abduction by itself, I know certain of you, you wanted to know how that did happen. So for me, of course, it's very, very boring because I've done that about 4,000 times. But certain of you, you like that part. Now, we are in a parallel universe. We are walking there, and we are going to an absolutely round spacecraft waiting for us there and shimmering, about levitating about 10 meters over the ground, their ground, that parallel universe ground. And we went there, and then at that time, I have to tell you, I've been scared, because I say, that's it. It's no more a dream, because I pinch myself, I say, oh, I'm not dreaming. She laughed at me, she said, yeah, no, you're not dreaming. We don't want you to think you're dreaming. So I knew I was not dreaming anymore. Even she could read my mind like an open book when I was thinking I was not going to see my family again. She just turned and said, no, you'll see your family very soon, Misha. How could she doing that? Because she was absolutely mind-read. When I say she, it is because Tao, that extraterrestrial, looks exactly like a beautiful woman. But of course, huge. They can't even fit about the side of the inside of that stuff here. And very, very smiley, yeah, 10 feet high. It's a reason for that. It is because on their planet, you didn't read the book, eh? Not yet. I can pick everybody who didn't read the book. But, on their planet, the gravity is not like here, okay? Over there, I was 45 kilo instead of 70. So everything there is gigantic, okay? Like I say to her, if you read the book, why are you that size, you know? Normal size, I say. She said, no, it is a normal size for us, not for you, but what? Anyway, so that person, I say she, because she looks like a woman. Now, to be easier for the lecture, her name is Tao. Got a problem already. T-H-I-O, Tao. That's her name. You can pronounce whatever you want, but I pronounce it Tao. And she was my mentor from the beginning to the 9 day to the end of the 9 day. And you are going to ask me that later, so I tell you now. And she contacted me 2 more times, but only in astral and telepathically, since that's happened. Okay. Now we are aboard on that spacecraft, which was no porthole, no hole, no lidar, no little green man, I'm sorry for the science fiction people, but no lidar, and we levitate. She had this sort of apparatus, and she said, never touch me for a few seconds. She was very serious about it. I didn't understand why. It was maybe dangerous. And we simply levitate, and when I really thought I was going to bump in a spacecraft, a sort of piston went inside, and we land on a platform inside the spacecraft. And then I had a big problem with my eyes, because the colors inside were very, very strong, and I had to wear a mask, and she was telling me they were destroying my dangerous bacteria inside me, who was dangerous for them. In a calf, they were destroying it, cleaning me by the vibration, because for them, they explain when it's a color is a vibration. And by vibration, you've got somebody behind you. And the colors are vibration. And the vibrations
do a lot of things. Vibration can heal you and even kill you. But that is another story later. Now I am in a spacecraft. I'm not going to tell you all the stuff in a spacecraft. You can read it quietly for hours. And then we went to the planet named Tiaouba. Now, I'm sure about everybody in that room say the same thing wrong, because we don't understand. The physicist explained to us is the galaxy and the universe so big, stars and planets are light years from us. So how Michel Demarque can go in 9 days and 8 nights at the other side of the galaxy, at billions and billions of kilometers away, and came back in such time, even at the speed of light, which is more than 380,000 kilometers per second. And you are right, because it is impossible. Is it 380,000 kilometers per second? Pardon? Oh, yes, that's it. Thank you. The bad sense. So even there, you can't do that. And it's quick. Can't do that. So how did I do it? I didn't do anything. They make me doing it. Okay. Those people simply know how to transubstantiate. Maybe you never heard of the name. Don't worry, because I talked to scientists on that planet. They were interested in me. And they didn't really understand what it was either. So you have transubstantiation, which is not transformation. Everybody knows transformation. With, which means substance. Transubstantiation. I explained to you, it's very simple. That table, the building, us vibrate at the speed of light. If you have the technology to accelerate the vibration of this table or this bottle, whatever you want, take the table, you have the technology, take the board of accelerate the vibration, the board is going to disappear in front of you, that invisibility. Now, at that moment only, if you also have the technology, you can, when the board is invisible, transport that board on the moon, example, just like that. Over there, you slow down the process, and the board reappear on the moon. That is transubstantiation. Believe me, those people do that with the entire spacecraft. We were 13 people aboard, 12 astronomers, if you want to call them astronomers, inside the spacecraft, plus me, and I didn't even feel it. But don't think it works like that. They go first at the speed of light, then they go in a space, and then very far away, because if they do that, example, in our solar system, they blow up, everything explodes. They would have a terrible accident. So they do that on the middle of space and reappear at the other end of the galaxy or wherever they want to reappear, but they re-slow down the process there. So finally, to tell you, if we talk about our time here on the planet, I spend about 16 of our time, our hours, in a spacecraft to go and to come back. 16 hours. Now when we arrive, excuse me 1 minute. You better stop. I have to take Steve. See Steve? I'm terrible for that.
Sure.
Yeah. You put 1 minute. Later on you're going to put that. That one when I tell you. And when I tell you, you continue. Is that one all right? Yeah, okay. Okay. So after all that time, And 16 hours we didn't waste any time, because Tao told me lot of things. For those who read the book, I couldn't be absent very, very much, because it's a universal law. I could die to be on planet of different category. So they had to hurry up to give me information. So we didn't stop in a spacecraft full of information. Then finally we arrive at what I wanted to call Golden Planet, because I saw on a panel, it was all television panel, there's no porthole there, and we can see, and we saw a planet coming, which was their planet named Tiaouba. Now, I wanted to call the book the Golden Planet, because I call a chapter Golden Planet. It's a sort of golden mist around the planet, like you call the blue mountain here because you got a bluish mist, but that it was a golden mist. It's beautiful. Then we arrived there, and I saw that, so finally we saw Zoom, and we saw oceans, islands, like you, when you came with a plane on a planet, that very, very, very luminous. Then finally, steady, we land. And on the panel, I've been very, very, very surprised, but I wasn't surprised or surprised, and I saw half egg on the ground like that. All like that, like that one, all like that. I said, what is that? You've got eggs, you don't have building on that planet. She said, it is our building. They are named on their language, Doko. Dokos with an S if you want to. Dokos, phonetically what they call them, Doko. And she said, no, Michel, they're not eggs. They are our building, they are force field. We build a force field, and we use it as a building for anything, the sun, the rain, the wind. And it was amazing. But she says, that's not important. As I said to the lady before, the importance here is the gravity. We are gigantic because we don't have the same gravity. You have two problems on our planet before we go out. The first is you are going to be unbalanced, because on Earth you were 70 kilo, and with difference of gravity you are going to jump a bit and be about 45 kilo. The second is more important. We are going to give you a mask to cut 75%, 75% of the luminosity of our planet. It was terrible. The luminosity was very, very strong, and I could be blind. So they gave me a mask, and then finally we disembark, I can say. Then I got the shock of my life, of my ego. Because I say, oh my God, I'm an alien here. I'm going to have a red carpet, television, journalist, and all that. Why not? Nothing. Nobody. We were Tao and I. I got a shock. My ego been hurt. I'm only joking. It's true, a bit. Okay. And we walk to what I call, and they call a lativok, but they call, I call that a flying platform. That's the shape it is. And you can sit down here, and she sat down here. So use it. It's very interesting. If I don't use it, because I can forget, it's so many things to say. At the question time, you remind me about that center. Now, what's happened? I was in a different universe. I saw people passing a bit further in last century costume. And I say, who are those people? And she said, we are in a parallel universe to Earth. Here, the time stopped. Those people are there for hundreds of years. If you stay here 200 years, you can go out, example, and look exactly the same age 200 years later. I didn't understand quite at that time, but I explained that, of course, in a book very, very well. The parallel universe is a sort of curse all around the planet. Now I'm going to explain to you something. The planet Earth, everybody heard, I hope, about the Bermuda Triangle.
And simply, around the planet, you have a parallel universe turning around it. And that parallel universe, if you remember the Bermuda Triangle, by the way, is a place where people say, plane disappear, ship disappear, people disappear, object disappear, birds disappear. So many people say, oh yes, yes, it is the UFO, it is what they call a flying saucer, picking people and kidnapping them. It is not. It could, because it is UFO, which are different of my aliens, but it is not there. Same other people say, oh yes, it is the pyramid of Atlantis which trapped people. It's also false. It is simply the parallel universe is flipping like a sheet of nylon in a wind and same time touching our universe more often on the place of that Bermuda Triangle, that place in Atlantic. It is a very well-known place. So each time if the parallel universe touch that place, it's at the same moment a ship, a plane, a human being passed, disappear and trap in a parallel universe. The parallel universe is a different dimension of our dimension. So when you go there also you are trapped, as I say already a few times, and as I talk to Tao, it's a curse, difficult, some people came out of it by accident also as they went on and they are fortunate. Some became amnesia, they don't remember what's happened. Others came also out and they don't want to talk about it because they say, if I dare to talk about what's happened to me, everybody is going to think I'm a cuckoo. And some people even take me for a cuckoo. Do I look like a cuckoo?
Can't tell it by looks.
Good. Like the cover of the book. Okay. Now, at that moment, Tao told me that, and she said, we are going to take you for a trip, as I said before. And I said, you must be joking. What for? And she said, you are going to witness what we are going to show you with your physical body and report it in a book. I say, you must be joking, because I'm a gardener, I'm not a writer. Why don't you take a writer or a journalist? You had good writers, she says. That's a good question, because Plato was a good one, but he's dead long time ago. Victor Hugo was a good one too, but he's dead also. And the journalists are making too much of sensationalism. We need you to report word for word what you are going to witness and to put the information in a book, and we'll help you to do that. She didn't tell me at that moment why they choose me, but we'll talk about that later. By the way, before to go further, I forgot to tell you something very important. You are all here in that room, that lecture. We are going to talk about astral body, astral travel, space travel, stars, Big Bang, and so on and so on. Thousands of books have been written on that. I am sorry. And my name is Michel Demarquet. Certain of you saw me, certain never seen before. And I have to thank you very, very much to be interested on what's happened to me in June 1987. And I'm sure you're all here because you want to know more about it. I know a lot of you read the book. You are dying to ask questions. We will do the question at the end of the lecture. Don't worry, you can ask plenty questions. Now, for those who haven't read the book at all, how many of you didn't read the book?
Yeah. Good. Few. Okay. So I have to start from the beginning, which was during the night. I was sleeping very quietly in my little hobby farm over there in North Queensland, when suddenly I wake and I was thinking it was the morning, you know, ready to go, fresh, like you had a good night's sleep. Then I went to the kitchen, and in the kitchen I was surprised to see it was 12:30. I dressed up. At that moment, I have to explain to you, because people don't understand really, maybe in a book. At that moment, I became like a zombie in my own house, like if I was telepathized by something, hypnotized. Then I wrote a note to my wife, darling, I will be away for 10 days. Oh, why did I do that? It was like two Michelle, one watching the other doing that. I put the note under the telephone. I turned around, I went under the veranda, went down there, and down the stairs, and same time I call it backyard, it's not backyard, it's sort of bushy stuff behind the house because I live next to the rainforest. And I continued to walk. When suddenly under my feet, the ground became bluish, reddish, everything distorted at the light of the star. I could see the house distorted. The philodendron, which is, somebody knows, is a beautiful plant on a tree next to me, start to distorted. And I say, oh, sort of waking up, what am I doing here? I'm sick, I want to go home. And at that precise moment, I've been lifted from the ground and passed on another dimension. At that part of the book, the translator said to me, oh, because the book being written in French originally, and my English is not good enough to write directly in English, unfortunately. And translator say, Michel, you should change that part of the book, because suddenly you are in your garden, after that you are sitting on a rock somewhere else. I say, I'm very, very sorry, I prefer to explain that later, but I can't change anything in that book, except the postscript, which is really what I think about it. That the rest have been forbidden to me to change one word of it. So I can't change that part, even if I don't like that part myself. So what's happened when suddenly I appear, as I say, in front of a huge human being, 10 feet high, who look at me with a smile, a transparent helmet, and say, oh, everything will be all right, Michel, in French, which is my own language. I say, you must be joking, I'm dreaming, because we are in Australia, first of all, why do you speak to French to me? And she say, I say, we speak English here, and she says, so do I in English. So I say, that's it, it's a dream, I'm going to fall upon a carpet, I'm dreaming, I'm in my bed. And she say, no, you are not dreaming, we came, we don't want you to think you are dreaming at all, we came to pick you up physically, and to make you doing a trip which nobody ever done, at least on this century, on this planet. You have to remember, all of you, that sentence, because later in a lecture, we are going to